Welcome, everybody, to the September 18th, 2019 City Council meeting of the Imperial Beach City Council. And we need to reconvene the closed session meeting. City Attorney Lyon will report on a closed session.
Mr. Mayor, the council met in closed session on item one. Direction was given. No reportable action was taken.
Great. Thank you. And now I am adjourning the closed session meeting and then now calling the regular meeting to order. As a courtesy to others, please silence your cell phone or turn it off. We all need a break from our cell phones for sure. During the meeting and engage in conversations outside the chambers, the city clerk has an announcement.
If you are here to speak under public comments or on an item on the agenda, please fill out a request to speak form. They're located in the back of the room. When you're done filling it out, please submit it to the deputy city clerk right here. And also keep in mind that the timer is located behind the council. So keep an eye on that as you're speaking. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much. Madam Clerk, please take the roll.
Councilmember West.
Here.
Councilmember Spriggs.
Here.
Councilmember Aguirre.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Patton.
Here.
Mayor Dedina.
Here. Great. And now we have Pledge of Allegiance. Mr. West, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I would be honored to. Put your hand over your heart. Repeat after me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do I get a picture now?
Yes.
Yes.
Very good.
I knew that was coming.
And an ice cream. And now we have council assignments and committee communications from city staff, starting with Council Member West.
Yes. Good evening, everybody. On September 5th, was the San Diego County Regional Airport Authority, our executive committee meeting. A few things we took about, we're really pushing on the EIR for the Terminal 1 will be released in the next couple of weeks. So be ready for that to be reviewed, and I welcome all public to take a look at that document. It's going to be a really great document to look at. Also, on September 6th, I would like to reserve a little time when we bring up the RENA vote to talk about my votes for that time, and I'd like to just hold it until that time when we actually take it on the agenda. And then on September 11th, I was honored. Our Fleet Reserve Association invited me to come on our September 11th and talk about my experiences that happened in 9/11. And it was that's something that's very important to me. I was actually in the officer of the deck on a ship that was one of the first to launch Tomahawk missiles against the Taliban in response to 9/11. So they had come, and the reason why they had me come was actually they have what's called their Widows Fund. And this is a fund that's actually put together that was taking care of people who lost loved ones, that if they didn't have the money to help them with burial costs and future living, that they would actually give money to them. Well, for some reason, this actually has been folded. So they decided, the great people of our Fleet Reserve decided to give over $5,000, the leftover of that money, to our Boys and Girls Club here in San Diego. So it was really great to see that the Fleet Reserve Association is not only raising the money, but taking the money and putting it back into our community. So I was honored to be there and to see that check. I just wish the Boys and Girls Club would have showed up, but that's neither here nor there. And then on September 12th, I was the San Diego County Regional Airport Authority. I was the audit committee. And then on September 14th, it was a great day at our park. I was happy to be a part of the Mayor's Fitness Challenge and watch our Ironman and our public safety people really come out. And we tried our best against all those Ironmen, and unfortunately, we did lose that portion. But wait. When it came to the beach portion where we did the beach runs, what was that? What do they call that run there, Mayor? When they do the beach and they get...
Oh, beach flag.
Yeah. So our own female lifeguard beat all of the Ironman people and all of our safety committee, and it was such a great time. And I have to admit, it was really equal play for equal pay, if you know what I mean. So it's good to see, and I was happy to be a part of it. So, and then hey, I'm calling everybody to look out this weekend. I Love a Clean San Diego is holding their cleanup this weekend. It's our at Bicycle Village from 9 to 12, and I hope I can see you all there. And that's Bicycle Village, 9 to 12, September 21st, Coastal Cleanup Day. So, great.
Great, thank you, Mr. Briggs.
You mean Bikeway Village, right?
What did I say?
Bicycle.
Oh, yeah, Bikeway Village. Thank
okay,
you.
Just so people go to the right
yep.
place. Yeah. Great. This 1 month period is really, for me, a heavy engagement period for contributing to and learning more about the coastal challenges we face in California and Imperial Beach, including sea level rise. On the 10th, last Tuesday, I went to the Nossaman Law Firm's annual coastal law conference on legal issues associated with coastal management, and particularly the challenge of adaptation to sea level rise, et cetera. And that was, there were a lot of experts. It was really very, very informative. On the 13th, many of us on the City Council attended the South County Economic Development Council's Economic Summit at the Convention Center, and that was very well attended and very very informative as well. The mayor was one of the panelists who spoke on the elected officials panel at that conference. On the 17th, that's this just this Tuesday, yesterday, I attended and spoke on one of the panels at the American Planning Association California Branches conference, which focused on coastal issues. And the workshop that I was a member of was entitled Coastal Conundrums. And I was the only elected official on that panel. The rest were senior planners from Marin County and other cities in the state. And basically we looked at all the different aspects of the challenge of dealing with coastal issues from a planning and looking at alternatives standpoint. Managed retreat was a major point of discussion at that meeting, as well as at the legal conference the week before. And finally, I think it's next week or the week after, I will be attending the University of California Irvine Coastal Resiliency all-day workshop. The mayor is going to be a speaker at that workshop. And there we're going to get a sense of the science of climate change and sea level rise. So in 1 month, it's legal, it's planning, and it's science, all associated with this challenge that really is a critical and existential challenge for Imperial Beach because of our particular geographic location. So I'll be reporting back on those future meetings as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Whitfield.
Good evening, everyone. So on September 12th, I attended the MTS board meeting. We didn't take action on anything, but we had a few items of informational items, a report on Comic-Con, an update on the Desert Baja Rail project. But most importantly, we're discussing the trolley connection to the airport. And they did some research, and there's a couple options that are feasible. One of them actually requires FAA approval, and we're looking into funding to make sure that we could, you know, fund that project and have it be successful. Basically, the whole goal is to improve connectivity with downtown and into the airport, so stay tuned for that. September 12th, the same day, I attended the IBWC Citizens Forum meeting. We had an update from the county on the 507 study, the list of projects that are being proposed for the Tijuana River Valley to address water quality and transboundary trash and tires. We were also visited by Chief of Staff of Senator Ben Wesso. He shared with us his progress on his Bill 690, which has to do with the Tijuana River Valley, as well as his $15 million budget allocation that he successfully basically won for us for the Tijuana River Valley. It's the first of its kind. And then the most important point, I think, for everyone in the room was the most recent sewage spill that has been affecting our beach water quality for the last 2 weeks. September 4th, we started to have transboundary flow. Nobody told us for 3 days. We didn't know if it was because of failure of the pump station, Sela, or why, but the wet weather has ceased for like at least 2 weeks, and we continue to have a very large volume of flow. So September 17th, a few days later, Mayor Dedina, myself, Commissioner Rafael Castellanos, and Surfrider, we held a press conference to call on President Trump for help. I personally begged him to help us in light of his travel today to San Diego. We hear that he may have mentioned the border sewage crisis.
I'm getting conflicting. KSI said he didn't, so we'll see.
CBS 8 was streaming all day his visit from the moment he landed in Miramar to the Grand Hotel to Otay Mesa border crossing, and I didn't get a chance to hear that, but we'll see in the news tonight. Hopefully we caught his attention. And then Monday, I attended, along with Deputy City Manager Cortez, the MTS Community Outreach Meeting at the Ivy Library, at the library, for the South Bay Rapid Bus Feeder. This is really important because right now what's being proposed is a rapid bus route from Otay to Imperial Beach. And what they want to know is, what does the community need? And that's why we need your help. We need your feedback, because does that mean that it's going to travel down 3rd Avenue, or should it travel down 2nd or down Seacoast? I mean, whatever the path is, we want to hear from you. So we'll make sure that we put up the electronic survey link on our social media and hopefully on our website. And there's going to be a subsequent meeting later in November, so stay tuned for that as well. I really encourage you to come out and provide your feedback, because this is very important to us. It'll mean shorter commute times if we want to go to Otay or connect to the rapid bus to downtown. And that's it. That's it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
Yep. Thank you. First of all, I want to congratulate our own assistant city manager, Steve Dush, back there, who raised your hand, Steve. He completed the Ironman last weekend, which is a feat. So, congratulations. I got tired just watching. Coming up on September 28th, the 16th annual Dempsey Surf Contest. 16th, that's a legit. That's a means it's been around for a long time, and so I look forward to being there, helping out, and you should show up. There's a lot of, what's that? I'm just tired watching them. I'm just gonna go watch. So definitely go down there and watch a lot of talent. And then on the 28th on the pier, and this is a crucial on time, from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. the Kiwanis, they're holding a Kids Ocean Discovery Day, where actually they'll have divers in the water pulling up buckets with creatures, and the kids will actually get to explore and learn about what our ocean has to offer, as well as environmental stewardship for future generation. And so I think that's a big deal. I did see on the news today, and maybe we could follow up with Sweetwater District, Oceanside is taking bids for their $16 million aquatic center. It'd be nice to find out where Sweetwater's standing. I haven't heard anything about the pool for a while. So
I think they're dealing with their bond measure. Stuff,
right. The bond. So hopefully at least something. So yeah. So and that's it for me. Thank you.
Great. Thanks. I want to thank just the Ironman organization, especially the Ironman Foundation. What the philanthropic effort around the Ironman, I think it was $25,000 they donated locally, a $10,000 check to the Navy SEAL Foundation. And then the whole component of Gold Star families and recognizing, I think they kind of adopted one family, right, a Gold Star family, and then raised money for that family, right? There was a firefighter that had done the rent.
His name is Fireman Rob. He's an Air Force officer who has actually been kind of going around the country, and we're actually working with the Iron Man Foundation to actually promote work.
So yeah.
He's an honor.
Thanks for that reminder. It was really, really moving, and a really moving ceremony on Saturday, the donation of the check. And so a really high-end event in terms of just the professional attitude, and then more importantly, the cooperative relationship with the community and our military and our veterans. So really, really impressive. Love the Mayor's Fitness Challenge. Really liked the fact that our public safety officer staff all got together and challenged the Ironman team. And then had a great kids event as well, which was really great to see the kids there. So people's feedback on IB was great. Congratulations, Steve. And then Zach Malcolm, the son of Dan Malcolm, was one of our lifeguards. Dan's our port commissioner, competed, apparently did really well, knocked an hour off his time. And then Shane Landry, whose father, John Landry, is a legendary SEAL team member, like beyond legendary. And a great IB dad. Shane competed as well. And Shane's a great swimmer. And then Hans Renan, an ex-IB lifeguard, competed as well. So I'm sure I'd like to get a whole... We need to find out all the IB residents that did it. But that's the hardest triathlon swim in the world. There's not a harder triathlon swim anywhere. And I've been competing in ocean swimming for 35 years. There's no Ironman or triathlon swim where you go two times through the surf. That's hard. Going once through the surf is hard. Doing it twice, and generally the surf is pretty big. Even this year, the surf was smaller, but it's still pretty gnarly. Like, it's not easy. And IB is the hardest place to do a rough water swim anywhere. So
and the 8 mile.
That's not including the run on the beach, which is legit in the sand. So as a former lifeguard, and Mr. Patton, I know it's not easy to run in the sand 100 yards. So not a half iron, half marathon. So really impressive event. So really, really liked it. In terms of water quality, lots of stuff going on. So we had the South County Economic Development Council meeting last week. The big deal with there was Mario Chacon, who's the ambassador for North America for the Foreign Ministry of Mexico. Basically the highest level official besides the foreign minister that works with the United States, the guy who's been helping negotiate NAFTA, was there. I had managed to get 5 minutes with him. We had met with him in Mexico on the chamber trip in, I think it was in April. And then I met with him again in Cabo this summer. And so the thing is, we're gonna be at the White House next week. I'm gonna be there with Coronado Mayor Richard Bailey, County Supervisor Greg Cox, and then San Diego Mayor Kevin Faulkner, asking for the president's budget to include funding for fixing the Tijuana River issue. And it was clear what their ask from Mexico is: you need to let the White House know. Apparently, Jared Kushner is really good friends with the foreign minister of Mexico, and then another member of the AMLO administration is also good friends with Jared Kushner. Mm-hmm. And so we wanted them to make sure they let the president's team know that Mexico is funding this issue. And so Ambassador Chacon said they'd already let them know. More importantly, a member of the consular service will be attending that meeting with us to confirm that Mexico's on board with this. And so it's really critical. And our message has been very clear: Mexico needs to pay their fair share. This is not, we're talking about U.S. side infrastructure to catch our sewage, but Mexico needs to upgrade its own sewer system. And with that, Andy Hall, Paloma Geary, and Chris Helmer and I met with Rigoberto Laborin. He'll be the new sewage director starting in November, working for the governor. And he made it really clear there's 19 pump stations in Tijuana. Is that correct, right? 19 pump stations. They're all failing. None of them are managed correctly and cleaned correctly. And that his argument was, we need to buy hardware from the U.S. in the U.S., make sure that we pass it across the border and replace those pumps with pumps that work. And yet he argued that would make a big difference in reducing sewage spills, because the sewage spill we just had is obviously a pump station. And so we're hoping to get new leadership and management to deal with this issue. We'll see. But it's clear that we're kind of reaching a point where hopefully we'll see if the president puts in his budget, that'll be a big thing. When you have a Senate budget, a congressional budget, and the president's budget, and if the president's budget only has zero in it, then it's really hard to reconcile those. So that's what's important this year, to get the president's budget to fix this issue. And then I want to just thank our sheriff, Lieutenant Juan Marquez, and the sheriff's team for having a coffee yesterday morning. Community room was great with the community, really, really great turnout as well. And it was great to answer a lot of questions and get feedback from the community. Here's some good news for you. One of the lowest crime rates in the county, even lower than Coronado, and Coronado spends twice as much as we do on the police force. $12 million a year for Coronado, $6 million for us. So really proud of the work that our sheriffs do, but it's a community effort. You see something, say something, let us know. Whether it's graffiti or crime, let us know immediately. And then we let the sheriffs know immediately. That's around the clock. And I really like the fact that Lieutenant Marquez is available around the clock every day of the week. And he responds immediately. There you are. Thank you. Can we give the sheriffs a round of applause? And we'll go to public comment. Kim Frake from the IG.
I just had a couple of things.
Oh, you have it. I'm sorry.
First, we want to announce coming up on October 5th, a Symphony by the Sea. It's a great event. Hopefully, everybody will get. It's on October 5th.
Okay.
And that's when the San Diego State Symphony Orchestra comes down and plays at Pier Plaza. So that's great. We have a legendary employee who worked with us for a long time. We all know and love Hank Levine. Hank lost his wife in the last couple of weeks since we met last. So I know most of you know Hank. If you can keep him in your prayers, Hank's had a lot of challenges of his own. But we sure miss him around here and just wanted to make sure that everybody was aware of that. There'll be some services this Friday and Saturday for his wife, and we all have Hank in our thoughts. So I just wanted to make sure to share that. Thanks, Mayor.
Great, thank you. And now a couple of comments. Kim Frink from the IB Collaborative, Suncoast and IB Collaborative.
Good evening. My name is Kim Rivero Frank, and I'm an IB resident and board president of Suncoast Market Co-op. I just wanted to give you some very quick updates. October is National Co-op Month, and Suncoast has a lot of activities planned over the next couple of months, including guest speakers, healthy cooking classes. We just had a Thai cooking class last weekend. We partnered with Siam Imperial Restaurant, who taught the class, and Coronado Kitchen and Bath on Palm Avenue. They have a beautiful demonstration kitchen, so they're allowing us to do cooking classes there. We're very excited about that. I brought a flyer for the council, and information about our events is available on our website and Facebook page. Tomorrow evening, we will be at Seaside Candy at 6 p.m. for an information session that's open to everyone. So please encourage your neighbors and friends, if they haven't joined Suncoast, to come out and find out more. We encourage people to come and ask questions and learn more about how we as a community are going to open an awesome community-owned grocery store that has a greater focus on healthy, local, and earth-friendly food and products. We currently have 350 co-op owner members in our community and neighboring communities. Our goal is to reach 500 by the end of this year. And 500 is an important milestone because at that point, based on the experience of other food co-ops, we can feel confident that we have the community support needed to open a successful store and can start looking for a site and location for the store. We want to get to 500 as soon as possible because we know there's a lot of things happening in IB and we don't want to miss out on an opportunity for that perfect site. We'd like to come back and provide a formal presentation to the council maybe in November or December. To provide you with information on next steps for opening the store and some ideas on what the city can do to support this effort. And you all have been super supportive already, so we appreciate that. And lastly, on a separate note, I just wanted to remind everyone that the IB Collaborative meets on the fourth Friday of each month at 8 a.m. at the South Bay Union School District office at 601 Elm. The Collaborative began with Mayor Dedina's leadership 5 or 6 years ago, I think. We're still meeting, and it's a great place to connect with other organizations that serve IB. Our next meeting is tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, and we're going to have a legislative update from Senator Ben Hueso and presentations from the IB Women's Club and Suncoast Market Co-op. So I hope some folks can come out and join us, and thank you for your time and support.
Thank you so much, Kim.
Sure.
Mayor Thomas Crenbaugh. After Thomas is Mitch McKay, then Eric, and then Erica, I think.
Good evening, everybody. First, I'd like to make comment on what you said about the environment of what Mexico do. I used to be in charge of monitoring all environmental projects in the Imperial County and San Diego County. And when a contractor drop of oil in the new river, this is Imperial County, I stopped the project until they clean and take care of their act. And one contractor said, Thomas, what are you doing here? Look what Mexico do. And I looked there, so there is something wrong with that picture. We spend a lot of money to clean our environment and what have you. And Mexico, we have no jurisdiction of what they do. They just like throw anything they want. So we're not being treated fairly. So something needs to be done. I agree with you.
Yeah.
I applied for permit a while ago, and Greg Wade, before he left, he made every effort, and I have witness here, the city manager, every effort he made to stop me. Finally, the permit went with the help of Mr. Hall, and my finances challenged, so I was building the project slowly. Damien came over and stopped my project and pulled the electric meter from two houses. He has the right, he had the right to give me notice of non-compliance if he saw something wrong, because I'm under permit and I'm doing everything. I'm still in the process of building, having the room addition. So what he did, extremely wrong. And after 1 year, they came back, the unit that has nothing to do with the construction whatsoever, that separate meter, separate everything, and he removed the meter. This is not right. I know safety. I work in nuclear power plant. I was safety director. I was safety director at the San Diego airport and with the state of California. Any project go, I participate. And I changed the OSHA safety manual, some recommendation, and I have a record of that. So I'm not new to safety and has nothing to do with safety. It's all about retaliation, and I don't agree with what they did. They removed the electric meter, and then they said, okay, now we're going to put the electric meter. What are you playing with my life? My house was in the auction block. I saved it at the last minute. 1 minute, I would have lost my house because of some retaliation from the city of Imperial Beach. And not the city of Imperial Beach. Lori Berman, the Caltrans manager, she was my mentor. She was forced to leave. I'm not going to speak about a lot of things. I've seen a lot of things. I've seen corruption. And it's touching the city of Imperial Beach. And I urge, Andy is a very nice man, I urge you to look what's going on in your room. It's not right. And my request now, I have an existing house. It has nothing to do with the addition. The addition there and the house here. And they don't want to put the electric meter to me. They can block the electric from the new addition until they're happy with whatever issue they have. But the existing house, I need my electric. Enough suffering. Enough suffering. I urge all of you to see. And why did Damien leave? He said, Thomas, I'm going to work with you closely. Bang, he left. Was he fired? Was he caught doing something?
Can you wrap it up, Mr. Kumba?
I'm sorry?
Can you wrap it up, please?
That's all I need. So please allow me. Bring somebody and put the electric meter so I can have for the existing house. The new addition, if they have a problem, they have every right to say, Thomas, you have this and this and this wrong, do it. And they gave me a big piece of paper. They say you need to comply. Okay, that's for the new addition. But the existing house, please put the electric meter.
Right.
Thank you for all
Thank
of
you so much. Mr. McKay.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council, and staff. Mitch McKay, 714 Holly Avenue, Imperial Beach, California. I've been a property owner here since 1990. I have a prepared statement that I'd like to read to the mayor and the city council tonight. I attended the most recent SANDAG board meeting on Friday, September 6th. I was very disappointed to see politics as usual usurp the real opportunity to do the fair and right thing. Many private citizens spoke passionately about their perceived negative impacts on their small cities, most notably Lemon Grove, Coronado, and Imperial Beach. This was all done during the public comment portion of the meeting and was open to the public. These individuals practically begged SANDAG to use logic, reason, and sanity to fairly apply the intent of the albeit flawed one-size-fits-all RENA methodology. Instead, yes, this was yet to be another case of poor governance by SANDAG. Yes, eventually the city of San Diego pulled their magic trump card and forced a reroute of the members to what's known as a weighted vote, a vote in which the city of San Diego ostensibly will never lose. There were also two alternate motions brought forward by the 18 city representative board. One came from Solana Beach Mayor Zito, and it was seconded by Coronado Mayor Richard Bailey. This alternative motion provided for what was known as, or what was called, a small cities adjustment, which, if approved and enacted, could have resulted in an up to 55% lowering of the RHNA housing quotas in these five small cities: Solana Beach, Coronado, Lemon Grove, Del Mar, and us, Imperial Beach. The only thing that was more disheartening than the display of overall poor governance by the SANDAG board that day was the fact that this alternate motion lost by a single vote. And guess which city's representative cast one of those dissenting votes? Mr. Mark West. I would just ask you to remember this lack of leadership on Election Day, November 3rd, 2020. I'm glad to hear that Mark's going to have an opportunity to speak to this. But I wanted to leave you with this closing thought. It's oft times attributed to Mark Twain or even Abraham Lincoln. I'm not sure who actually said it. But it is better to be thought a fool than to open one's mouth and remove all doubt. Thank you.
Mr. Syverson.
Eric Syverson, Imperial Beach native. I was discouraged, and then I heard that. Thank you, Mr. West. Thank you. I appreciate the vote to increase the density in our town even more. We'll reach that 43,000 total build-out, no doubt in my mind. Council Member Aguirre, tell MTS they can take their rapid route, and they can add it to his vote to the RENA number, because a third bus route in the city of Imperial Beach absolutely will increase our RENA number according to the current calculations. Am I wrong? Anyone? Anyone at all support a small Imperial Beach that has avenues available for cars, automobiles, to travel to and from work, which is not in Imperial Beach, except that all of you work here. So you're like, you've got this strange concept, we'll ride, but I'll put an 4x8 piece of plywood on a bicycle. I'll drive it to Claremont Mesa. I'll work on it in my work project. This isn't even what I wanted to talk about tonight, but what Mr. McKay just outlined is so absurd. And quite honestly, it's out of your control. With the ADU laws right now, this town is going to be built to the hilt. The future of this town is located between 3rd and 4th across from Imperial Beach Gardens, and it's two massive units being built right now. That is the absolute future of this town, no doubt in my mind. No doubt. On top of that, you have narrowed all the major arterial highways, narrowed, as in from 12 feet to 10 feet, Mr. Hall. I know you don't like me to use that word narrowed, but these lanes are narrowed to slow traffic. Traffic will be 25 miles per hour from Georgia, the city limit, all the way to the beach, because no one talks truth about our city schools, all the commuter schools we have with the students that don't live in this place but commute from other places. School hours will be absolute traffic jams, as they are today. My four-way stop has had more pedestrian accidents in the last month than it has in the last 10 years. And that is only going to increase with the current redevelopment of Imperial Beach Boulevard. Absolutely only going to increase. You people are putting more people in town. Your revenue plans call for ecotourism. I imagine they're going to come in a car, because nobody will build dock access to bring a barge or a ferry or anything else for this town. No one will. No one has the courage. We'll send money to Mexico, money to Mexico, money to Mexico. We'll narrow our streets. We'll put everybody on a bike. We'll put everybody in a condo. There will be no open space, no green space, no local space. It will be short-term rentals. And if you sell a town in this house, sell it for every dollar you have. And if you rent a space, rent it for maximum market value. I'll see you at 2.3.
Erica Lowry.
I don't know how I'm going to follow that. Council and staff, I come before you tonight as a local mom. Nothing special, just a mom. I'm here to speak for those who have the smallest voices, our children. On Friday, September 6th, I picked up a friend to carpool to a meeting downtown. I also wanted to show her how school traffic, and I use this in quotes, could be handled if all parties are willing to work together. First, I want to clarify why I call it school traffic. Because at certain periods of the day, certain sizable areas increase in pedestrians, bicycles, and vehicles. This takes place around schools, in our city, as children are coming and going. Usually the time frame is 30 to 60 minutes before and after school is in session. I'm going to use Coronado as an example of what can be achieved through combined proactive measures. Coronado school zone is a few blocks. It goes this way, and then there's this little offset where kids from kinder through 12th grade go. That time before and after school is a driving disaster. Trust me, I do my best to avoid the high schoolers at that time. Kids on bikes, walking, very few are paying attention. So last year they did something. The city got together with the leaders of the various schools and the police department to come up with a safety plan. And I met with many of those leaders. One of them was a former principal who actually started off as an elementary school math teacher and was my high school math teacher. So these are people who have seen it over the many years. The city has a contract for certain streets to have professional crossing guards, those streets with very high traffic flows. The streets with lower vehicular flow, the police have worked with the schools to have trained adult crossing guards. Most of them are staff of the school district. The reason I bring this up is on September 6th, before the meeting downtown, my friend and I saw that there was another, at least the second of this school year, child hit by a car. I call upon staff and the sheriff to work with the school districts to find a solution for this ongoing problem. Evaluate the roads that need crossing guards, especially Connecticut and Imperial Beach Boulevard, the hours that are necessary, and if necessary, enter into a contract with a private entity. Our children's lives are worth it, right?
Thank you. Mary Hensley?
My name is Mary Hensley. I live at 1390 Loudon Lane. I own another house on 8th Street. Years ago, before many of you were even born, on the city council, there were gorgeous trees on both sides of Coronado Avenue. We would ride our bikes then and park under the restful shade. There were also huge trees where pelicans roosted. However, in the name of progress, every one of these beautiful trees were cut down, and today in their place we have congestion, concrete, air pollution, and cars. The same destruction seems to be going on today, so I have five questions for you all to answer. Number one, every tree and bush on the IB Boulevard from Seacoast to 3rd has been cut down. Where there was once shade, birds, nests, and little squirrels climbing up and down the trees, there now is nothing but concrete. Do you intend to replace any of those trees or bushes? Question number two. There was a lovely habitat there for butterflies and bees, which are wonderful pollinators. Their habitat has been destroyed. Will you replace it? As you know, these are endangered species, which we need for pollination. Number three. You are now cutting down the huge trees on IB Boulevard at Mar Vista High School. Are you going to allow this destruction to continue, and why? Number four, do you have your sights set on cutting down the trees where the egrets nest? And if you do, I would like to know the address of an environmental agency where I can go and protest to them about it. Number five, what justification do you have for destroying these trees and plants that are good for the environment, that are good for birds, for pollinators, that could curtail air pollution and are something restful for people to enjoy? And in its place, we are just given concrete, which does nothing, I repeat, nothing for the environment. So to reiterate, will you replace the trees and bushes you have cut down? Will you restore the habitat for the butterflies and bees that have been destroyed? Are you going to continue to cut down the trees at Mar Vista High School where that's all the shade there is there? Do you intend to cut down the trees where the egrets nest? I need an address if you do. Number five, what is your justification for all this destruction? If you are truly environmentalist, as some of you claim to be, I hope you reverse this damage that is being done to our city and don't let it become a city of concrete and pollution. Please stop this irreversible environmental damage that is being done to our city. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We have, and now we have consent calendar items 2.1 and 2.9. We have Mr. Syverson for consent item 2.3. See here. All right, is there a motion to approve consent calendar items number 2.1 through 2.9?
Second.
Please vote.
Motion carried unanimously.
Now we have item 3.1, adoption of resolution number 2019-8087, approving and authorizing the execution of a joint exercise of powers agreement, creating the San Diego Regional Community Choice Energy Authority and introduction of ordinance 2019-1187, authorizing and enabling the implementation of a community choice aggregation program and appointment of an Imperial Beach representative. City Hall Manager Hall will give the report. And just for information, correspondence was submitted to City Council as a last-minute agenda information as well.
Mayor and Council, I wanted to introduce the environmental specialist. I'm not even sure of her title, but she's everything environmental in the City of San Diego, Cody Hooven. And she has with her a guest who's going to help us understand a little bit about this. In very simple terms, what the City Council is considering tonight is whether or not the city should enter into a joint powers authority that would allow us to purchase power together with the City of San Diego and the City of Chula Vista, La Mesa, and Encinitas. But it will be then, we're simply purchasing power in behalf of SDG&E, who will continue to be the service provider in our community. And we also have Dinah Willier here from SDG&E, if you have any questions from SDG&E. So rather than me pretend to be an expert, we'll turn it over to the experts and let them give you some background information.
Ready for me? Thank you. Good evening. Hi. Thank you for having me here, Mayor Dedina and City Council members and Mr. Hall. Thanks for the invitation and for having us here. I'm Cody Hooven. I'll give you my full title. I'm the Chief Sustainability Officer for the City of San Diego and also the Director of the Sustainability Department there. And on behalf of the Mayor of our city, we're very excited to be here to invite you to join the Regional Community Choice Energy Program that's being formed through a joint powers authority. I'm here with Sean Marshall, kind of hiding behind this podium here. She's one of the folks we brought on board to help us move through this process and answer a lot of the questions we've had. She's the executive director of Lean Energy, and she has helped 9 other CCA JPAs in the state form. So any question that we've had, she's answered 9 times before. So hopefully she can help answer any of your questions that you may have. So just providing a little bit of background here, how does a Community Choice Energy Program work, or CCE is the acronym. The top line you see there is what we currently have. So our utility, San Diego Gas and Electric, currently buys power on our behalf. That first upper left box, and they also deliver that power through the transmission and distribution system. They make their profit off that middle piece, and then it ends up at the customers, residents and businesses and municipal facilities. The lower line there is what we're talking about changing. It's that first piece of this process. So it's allowing local governments through state-enabled legislation to take over the purchasing power of electricity for their residents and businesses within their municipal boundaries. And that's what we're talking about, is enabled in the state in 2002. I'm getting ahead of myself, but there are now 19 operational community choice energy programs in the state and a few more that are formed, but they haven't started serving customers yet. And most of them are done through a joint powers authority, which is really taking it, if your city decides to move forward with this, which we hope they do. You are then delegating that authority to a joint powers agency, which is multiple cities getting together and running that as one agency. So far, again, we see 19 of them operating in the state. There's one little one currently in the San Diego County and within the SDG&E's territory. It's Solana Beach. They're looking to also join a JPA. They formed on their own initially, and they're really small and and have been doing quite well for, I think, 2 years now, but are really eager to join a JPA and kind of find those benefits of economies of scale and just having more people at the table to help them. We do see throughout the state that within the next 5 to 10 years, the state expects 50, 60, 70% of the energy load to be served by community choice programs and moving away from investor-owned utilities. From the power purchase standpoint, the investor-owned utilities are still expected to deliver the power. So we have done a lot of work on this process. We have extensive outreach around the county on this. When we decided to move forward ourselves, we've done extensive research, and I'll share some of our data with you. And probably over-researched this out of an abundance of caution. And every CCA in the state, this is feasible again and again because they're finding just success in their programs. We reached out to all the cities in the region and said, anybody that's studying a community choice program, please come to the table and help us understand how we should make this joint powers authority work. An extensive outreach with your council, with staff around the county, with other CCA programs or CCE programs throughout the state to understand best practice. Now have the cities of La Mesa, Encinitas, and Chula Vista all have adopted a CCA ordinance and the Joint Powers Authority resolution to join our regional JPA, and then our own city council did last night successfully. So we hope to see other cities joining over the next year or two. But again, if I didn't say this already, we're here to invite you to join now. And I'll speak a little bit more to why. A couple of the issues are timeline. Let me talk about this first. So when we approached our own understanding of why this would work for our region, we approached a couple different, we had a couple different criteria that we wanted to look at to make sure it was good for our residents and businesses. In no particular order, but rate competitiveness and financial stability was one. So we wanted to achieve our climate action plan targets. We needed to get to 100% renewable electricity. Everything else in your climate action plan that's not energy is transportation, and that's just as hard, except that it's more expensive and it's more long-term and it's very infrastructure intensive. The pieces that aren't those, it's either behavior change, also hard, or transitioning your any sort of vehicles to be electrified, and so you want to do that through a clean grid. So that brings you all back to the grid. We needed to get those reductions for our own climate action plan, and I think most cities that are looking at this, community choice energy is one of the strongest tools they have in their toolbox, and also to achieve our greenhouse gas reductions. We didn't think that we could put forward any program that was achieving those climate goals if they were more expensive for our residents and businesses. So that was, you know, as equal to us was, is this going to be rate competitive or rate savings for our customers? And is this organization that we're creating financially stable? So is it tested and proven? Can we follow best practice? Can we demonstrate, at least if not profitability, financial stability and sustainability over time? There's additional benefits that we really looked at that were nice to have, and those are local economic development, local power development. You know, those create jobs and benefits for our businesses and folks that live here. Can people actually attend meetings now and engage with the rate setting, with their local board members that are representing them? Can they, is it a professionally operated organization? Can we hire staff that actually know how to do this type of work? Can citizens now participate in through a citizens advisory committee? So I don't know if any of you have ever attended a Public Utilities Commission meeting up in San Francisco. I don't know if anybody in the audience has. I don't know if you've ever been to a SDG&E board meeting. I'm guessing most of us have not. So this now really allows an avenue for citizens to engage on energy. And then the excess revenue that is generated, it is still a nonprofit government agency. So any revenue that's generated beyond the cost to run the program is invested right back in the community. So achieving our climate action goals, being rate competitive and financially stable, and then those additional benefits were something that we took seriously and found all to be true for this program. So additional benefits of community choice programs are in joining through a regional approach. So I'm guessing this is something that you will do now or later, no matter what. So the benefits of doing it now and with us through a joint powers approach is a few things. Economies of scale. So City of San Diego is big. Sometimes that's seen as a negative. We can't change our size. We're just, we're big, we're big boned. So that brings with us an economies of scale. So you have a fixed overhead cost for operating an organization, right? You're still gonna hire one CEO and one CFO, no matter if you're by yourself or if you're an organization. So you lower those fixed overhead costs and you spread them out over more customers. That means any extra funding you generate can go right back into the community and you're not paying duplicative overhead. The local control I talked about a little bit. So all members of this board will have one seat on this joint powers authority, and also one alternate board member representing their city. Our JPA, ours is the only JPA with 100% renewable energy stated goal explicitly in the JPA. So the state of California, I would argue that ours is now probably the most forward-thinking CCA JPA in the state. And we're on track to launch in 2021. So if you want to start seeing your greenhouse gas reductions by 2021, you have to file paperwork by the end of this year to the state. And we've been working all year to reach that goal, and we could bring you on board and do that. If you try to start on your own, you're gonna be delayed a year or two. There's nothing you could do to shorten that timeline because the state mandates that. It'll only extend beyond to 2022, 2023 or longer. And then larger community choice programs wield more influence. So if we do this all together, we're better together, and we kind of wield a greater influence at the state, both in the legislature and through regulatory proceedings that are coming up regularly. Joining us, we'd be the second largest CCE program in the state. You can imagine that wields some influence with the state now, whereas, again, often we all feel forgotten on a variety of issues from Sacramento and San Francisco. I'll talk just a little bit about cost components. Just to familiarize you with the operations a bit, there's several costs that go into operating a CCA. These are all the costs to operate, and these are overhead costs. So there's everything from exit fees. So you pay, when you depart SDG service, you have to pay them for any cost of power that they procured on your behalf. They sell that first. They sell it off to the open market. But if they're not getting all their return on their investment and what they've spent, they will charge that to the program that we're creating. There's O&M costs that include rate reserves and rate stabilization funds. So often when CCE programs see a spike in the market and costs go up, they dip into this rate stabilization fund to cover that difference, so they don't have to raise rates on their customers. The utilities do the opposite. If there's a spike in the market, you see, and they just had a hearing last night on this, they will raise rates to the customers to offset that. There's other technical components, capacity costs, are just kind of insurance power that you need to buy to make sure there's plenty of power. And then, of course, the cost of renewable energy, which we anticipate increasing over time to reach our 100% renewable energy goal. So all in, those costs, you see those bar charts over time. I promise this is the only numbers slide, detailed numbers slide anyway. And those costs increase over time because we're anticipating increasing the cost of renewable power over through 2035, which is our target date for 100% renewable energy. You see that black line hovering above the cost of operating a CCA over time? That is the cost of power for SDG&E based on our projections. So you see that consistently over time, the all-in cost for a community choice program that we can run here will be slightly lower than what SDG&E charges. So you're also now saving your ratepayers and your constituents money. And one other thing to mention there. So not only are you offering a bit of a discount on just the generation portion of their bills, it's not huge, although to the business community, that is on a fixed cost, even a slight discount, a 3-5% discount over time is significant of interest to them. But you also have a difference between the cost to operate the CCA and excess revenues that you can generate. Those, again, those are the monies that you're now able to invest back in programs. You could incentivize EV charging, electric vehicle charging in your community. You could incentivize rooftop solar further. We could have programs for workforce development around energy. It depends on what the board wants to do, but that's where that money goes. So governance, what's in the Joint Powers Authority Agreement? I talked through a few things. I'll just touch on them quickly, but these are generally the sections of the Joint Powers Agreement. It's not for a legal document. It's not too terrible to read, but these are the main sections, and it touches on a few things. The recital section really sets the the guiding principles of what we see this joint powers authority focusing on. And it touches on everything from getting to 100% renewable electricity by 2035 and having, it has a lot of inclusive principles. So thinking about low-income communities of concern and how we can make sure that they're addressed and also brought along in any sort of opportunities of this program. Having workforce development and local job creation and local power preference is also in there, and a variety of other preferences in the recitals. And then going through the rest of the document, one area that I'll point out, it talks about the board structure and what that looks like. So as I mentioned, you have a primary seat on the board, your city would be represented, and then you'd also have an alternate seat. Primary seat must be elected, the alternate can be elected or appointed by your board. It could be an executive level staff person or somebody you feel represents and is knowledgeable about energy. And each city can make that decision for themselves. The board voting structure is something we discussed a lot, and it's right now it's a one city, one vote, or one party, one vote structure first. So all votes must start at that level. And when we talked with other community choice programs throughout the state, all of them have some sort of weighted voting option, but it's never been used except for once, and it was to rectify an issue that they had missed in their original foundational document. But there is a weighted voting option that can be called. But in order to kind of soften our weight, what we did was we offered up, it requires three board members to call for that weighted vote, not two, it's typically two. And we've capped our own weight at 49%. So we'd actually be, in the founding structure of this, we'd be more like 70, 75% of the weight by energy load, but we capped our weight at 49%. That way the city of San Diego can't overrule others by themselves. And it must pass the weighted vote. If it is called for, it must pass by two-thirds or supermajority. So we made it essentially pretty watered down and really difficult to use that weighted vote, which was a pretty big concession on our part. Even my mayor was surprised at what I offered to other cities. And it has a couple of other things. I won't go through all of them, but it does have a community advisory committee. We made it mandatory, so we really want to make sure that the board has a way for citizens to be involved and be advisory directly to the board. And then the last one I'll point out here is the financial provisions section. The City of San Diego has offered, we're kind of the sponsor organization. We've been doing a lot of the legwork on this and the research, and we've offered to cover the cost of startup, which we will talk through some of the costs of this. So these are all based on best practices of other CCAs, especially East Bay Community Energy and Clean Power Alliance in LA. And they're kind of the two most recent, and they were kind of the gold standard for how to do this in the state because they were the newest and learned from the others. We are now the new gold standard, the platinum standard maybe. And we hope that others will be following kind of in our footsteps going forward. I am going to stop talking and let you hear from Sean, our expert on these issues, and then we're both going to be available for questions should you have any.
Cody. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Thank you very much for having me this evening. I'm going to take us through the rest of these slides. We'll move through quickly, and then as Cody said, we're available for your questions. As Cody mentioned, I have done a number of these now since 2014 was the first JPA that I worked on. I was also part of the founding board of MCE, which was the first CCA in the state of California that launched back in 2009. So it's been a long time. I do want to tip my hat to Cody and her team and all of the other staff from the various cities that participated. The JPA agreement that you have before you is well negotiated in good faith. It has been vetted by all kinds of internal and external attorneys. It includes all of the key points. I think one thing that's important to remember is that this is a legal formation document. It will then be followed up by either bylaws or operating guidelines, and very importantly, a number of policies. So the JPA agreement in and of itself is not meant to be the entire kitchen sink of all the agency policies. So I think it's important to keep that in mind. However, there are a number of risk mitigations contained within the document that I think you will find comforting. And really the most important one that I want to highlight here, I'll just call out a few of them, but the very most important one is that the reason that you form a JPA is to provide a legal and financial firewall between the liabilities and assets of the JPA and those of the members and the parties. So from a legal and financial perspective, there is a legal firewall so that nothing comes back and hits your general fund. That's a joint and several liability issue that's very important. A couple of other things just to reiterate. The governor, the governance structure and all of the major decisions will be made in public at monthly board meetings. And the JPA itself will be governed by, as mentioned, a board of directors, but it, the agency itself will be run by professional staff with background in utilities and energy and all of the relevant skill sets. The JPA specifies that it must follow all local zoning and building codes for any proposed projects that may be cited in one or a number of member jurisdictions. There is an annual audit requirement. There is a mandatory finance and risk management committee requirement. And finally, withdrawing members may be responsible for their stranded costs of departure. However, the JPA is obligated to mitigate that liability through both resale of power on the open market and using their reserves and ratepayer revenues to handle that kind of cost recovery. So there are a number of risk mitigations baked in. Cody referenced that the City of San Diego has stepped up to provide leadership in terms of funding the startup of this program, which is great. That is a huge weight off of your shoulders, because a lot of times when this happens around the state, all the different members have to put into the pot. And in this case, if you join this year as a founding member, you won't be obligated to do that. The city has already authorized $200,000. Some of that has been spent down already for my time and other people's time getting us to this point for planning. We anticipate another $5 to $10 million, and I'm guessing on the lower end of that, for the startup phase, which will commence in as soon as this part is done, sort of November through the spring of 2021, to handle all of the formation. That last category you see there really handles all of the capacity, the credit capacity needed to get into the power market. Again, that $120 million number is super high. Typically how it's worked is that you will have a line of credit from a third-party bank, and there are a number of them now that are providing credit, and you will phase your customers in, and revenues from those original tranches can then be used to pay for additional power needs as you begin to enroll your customers. So, you know, my two cents here is I don't think you're going to need $120 million line of credit. So it's good to understand what the timing is here and why we had to identify October 1st as the deadline for founding members to join. And the reason for that is that the CPUC has established a deadline for a CCA's implementation plan that must be submitted by the beginning of each year in order to launch service, not the following year, but the year after. So in this case, we will submit an implementation plan, hopefully just before the holidays, in order to launch service in Q1 of 2021. That is the plan right now. And so the plan is to have our first board meeting at the end of October, a second board meeting at the right before Thanksgiving, and a third board meeting somewhere around mid-December in order to adopt that implementation plan, get us into the queue, and get started. In addition, we are also working on the budgeting, an RFP for credit and banking services to take care of the line of credit that we referenced, as well as an RFP for energy services that we'll be issuing here pretty soon. So there's a number of things happening between now and the end of the year to make this all a reality so that we can go into full implementation phase throughout 2020. And this just shows you in a bigger picture the very watered down number of steps that are required to get a program like this off the ground. The thing I want to say, rather than go through all the bullets here, is that this JPA is on solid ground. We are on track to meet our timing obligations. We know how to do it. We know that we will attract a great team, hire great staff, and confident that as long as SDG&E is able to be a great partner with us, which we think they will, that we can launch in 21. So I'll just wrap by saying there are a couple of risks in delaying. We've had this question a lot. How come we need to do this now? Why don't we just wait a year and, you know, we'll launch service in 2022? And there are some very legitimate reasons why we urge you to join tonight. The first is I know that your city recently adopted a climate action plan. It has aggressive goals. CCA gets you there faster and meets those targets
really quite amazingly quickly. And so delaying just sort of reduces your momentum, reduces your ability to meet your cap goals as quickly as you'd like. From an economic perspective, your community, your customers living here and doing business here are going to continue to pay higher rates. So you're missing out on that projected discount. Power pricing and exit fees may also increase as we go along. So there's some market uncertainty that there is a very real risk of going up if you wait. Regulatory, right now there is no formal place at the table. There's a lot happening at the CPUC, and so forming this JPA will be able to get San Diego and its regional partners involved in some key proceedings. And finally, you know, political climates change. You all know that very well. And so one of the risks of waiting is that things can change. Your partners can change. Maybe you don't have the votes next time, all of that. So we urge you to join us this evening. And with that, I will end and happy to take your questions. Thank you. Okay, very good.
Appreciate this opportunity to speak on CCE and CCA. Been a long time coming, almost 20 years. The impact of climate change. Climate change is the most serious problem that our species, along with other most other species, has ever had to face. It's a global issue requiring local and global solutions to resolve its life-altering impacts. Adaptation is always brought up as part of the solution, but without serious mitigation, adaptation in many instances will not be possible. We have a great opportunity to implement mitigation locally and in the state of California, joining San Diego and others using community choice aggregation as a program to move forward with a solution to the climate problem. It requires a stepwise process leading Imperial Beach toward alternative energy self-sufficiency over time as policies change and are made at the federal, state, county, and community level. Ultimately, this process will lead to the to produce our own power locally, removing us from dependence on fossil fuels, ecologically destructive wind and solar farms, investor-supported and privately owned utility corporations, along with transmission corridors responsible for fires and ecological disruption. With the redistribution of finances from the fossil fuel industry to alternative energy and programs like CCA, CCE, we will see retrofit of homes with energy efficiency, solar panels, power walls, battery backup systems, electric cars, decentralized distribution of energy systems, and dollars benefiting the citizens of Imperial Beach rather than investors and corporations. Because of all these reasons, I want to encourage and support the mayor and council, along with the city staff, to move forward with the adoption of joining with others as part of the Community Choice Aggregation CCE program. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. McCoy. I appreciate it.
By the way, you got a guy over here that's done most of it already. I don't think he's left any part out, have you, Mark?
Thank you. Matthew from Climate Action Campaign. Matthew will be followed by Mr. Pilgrim, John Becker, and then Micah Matrosky.
Hello, good evening. My name is Matthew Vasilakis from Climate Action Campaign. Thank you to the council for this opportunity to speak. We're just really excited that Imperial Beach is considering this opportunity to join with San Diego, Chula Vista, Encinitas, and La Mesa for what will be a revolutionary program for our region and can really set an example for the rest of the country and the world. Imperial Beach's perspective on climate change as a frontline community is so necessary for the JPA board. We really want to stress equity and investing on programs that can address environmental and climate justice issues. And I know that Imperial Beach's perspective is absolutely crucial to ensuring that that happens. So again, from Climate Action Campaign and the San Diego Community Choice Alliance, we're very excited by your leadership on this, and we really hope that you'll join the JPA without an amendment or delay. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Pilgrim? Sorry, Dick, I'm calling you Mr. Pilgrim.
Frankly, this really pains me to be up here. My name is Dick Pilgrim, 1182 Fifth Street, Mayor Dedina, council members, city staff. I rise to speak against this thing, not because I'm opposed to climate change actions. I turned on my solar January 1, 2015. I use only LEDs. I have the lowest natural gas usage in my neighborhood, according to my billing. I think I do some things myself, and I generally oppose action. My difficulty lies in the Joint Powers Agreement. You've been talking recently a whole lot about SANDAG and the weighted voting, right? The weighted voting on this, according to the JPA, we would have no voice in any time it went to a weighted voting, because the weighted voting is what percentage of the total energy usage in a year that we have. We probably don't use as much energy as Qualcomm does, right? The whole city of Imperial Beach. So we have probably less than 1% voting power any time a voting share was called. Now, my objection then comes to when I look at the record of Chula Vista and San Diego, the two biggest users probably on here, maybe National City, okay? And their experience with acquisition and spending of money on large projects. We don't need to enumerate pension scandals, Chula Vista's sales tax fiasco down the line, da-da-da-da-da, and yet they would control it completely. Anything they say goes. Our board member would be there merely to say things. But when somebody says shared voting, we might as well walk away, because there will be no power whatsoever. I think that we should take this time right now to take steps for the staff to investigate how can we promote individuals to do more in the way of solar and wind production on their house, apartment houses, these new dwellings, which apparently SANDAG is going to force on us. We perhaps can join a JPA at some point. Not a bad idea in total. But I just see that Imperial Beach might as well not even bother. We really aren't going to contribute anything in the way of making decisions. But I get promised a 2% rate decrease. Promised a 2% rate decrease. If they do, the JPA, this CCA, is going to owe me a bunch of money because I'm not paying anything now. Thank you very much for your time.
John Becker.
Good evening. I'm John Becker, 1233 Loudoun Lane. By all news accounts and the San Diego slides we've just seen, the City Council has already decided to join the San Diego CCA, but here's my few minutes worth. The people of IB need to know that the IB city government is going to make big money off of our electricity usage with their CCA partnership. I'll repeat it. The people of IB need to know that the IB city government is going to make big money off of our electricity usage with their CCA partners. It is reported that San Diego will take $110 million a year of profit, or $1.75 billion in 16 years from the citizens' wallets. The city of IB will obviously take less, but IB is still taking money and profit off of the IB families. This is a grab for our cash, not about saving us real money. Otherwise, the CCA business model would be based on a zero profit or just break-even point versus getting a capital gain. The cities of San Diego are talking about putting their profits into their general budget. So we, as people, need to know that there is a profit centered here to to benefit the city governments. The IB City appears to be going into the electricity business for revenue at the taxpayers' expense. California state rules state this, that all members of the city must join the CCA and then later opt out on your own efforts. So the city of IB is going to be forcing every community member to be part of the CCA budget plan, to be a purchaser of the CCA electricity that's controlled by the city of San Diego. The individual user at my home who decides to not be part of the CCA must then jump through hurdles, bureaucratic hurdles, to disengage from the CCA. And then later, it's reported that if we don't do this within the first year, that we will have to pay an exit fee to pick our own electricity provider, which is currently SDG&E. Who really knows what the renewable energy costs will be in the future? As competition increases across the state of California, the price for renewable electricity will obviously go up, as the production is not going to meet the demand. So how much will be the fee to get out of this CCA in a year from now, 2 years from now, or 3 years from now? How much will the new member who comes to IB, who joins the community, who moves into a house, how much are they going to have to pay if they decide not to join the CCA? There are so many questions that are not answered by the local government that is going to affect the local citizen yet. We're talking corporate, not individual issues at hand. Please consider those issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Micah Matrosky.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Micah Matrosky, environmental organizer for IBEW Local 569, speaking on behalf of over 3,200 members. Today, your council is seeing a draft proposal for a community choice energy joint powers agreement. Unfortunately, there are serious concerns with this JPA proposal that need addressing, concerns shared by our allies at the Sierra Club. Elected officials at prospective JPA partner cities, including yesterday at San Diego City Council, have also voiced concerns. The proposal before you keeps the door open to nuclear energy and fossil fuels through renewable energy credits. The labor and workforce language is weak and in some places confusing, and the community engagement and transparency provisions are vague and lack accountability. We support launching a CCA program that benefits the community and ensures electric service begins in 2021. We need to get this right. As the CCA is formed, we urge Council to expeditiously address our concerns within the next few months. Changes are needed to ensure the program is on a path to deliver community benefits, 100% renewable energy, and to create local clean energy careers where workers earn good middle-class wages and benefits and have a voice through collective bargaining. I brought a copy of a letter that we sent earlier today, a joint letter with the Sierra Club, that I'm happy to distribute. Thank you, and we look forward to working with you and partner JPA cities.
Great, thank you so much. I'm now closing the public comment period. Before we start council discussion, could we have Sean Marshall up again just to answer the question?
Sure.
There was allegations made by Mr. Becker about price gouging and billion-dollar profits, and the city would be. So can you address that?
Sure, I'm happy to address that. In no uncertain terms, will there be any money that flows back into your general fund or the city of San Diego or any other member of this JPA. That is expressly addressed in the JPA agreement. So it's important to understand that any excess revenues will be used for really three things. One is a reserve fund, which handles rate stabilization. It handles any rate shocks in order to keep the rate discounts in place. It handles energy programs that the agency might like to offer, be it solar, electric vehicle, all of that. And the third thing that it will do is buy an increased portfolio of renewables. But that veil is not pierced. There is no money that goes back to any of the member agencies or their general funds.
And then the allegations made that residents are forced to join the CCA.
No. So it is true in the state of California, as well as CCA across the country, that this program is established by statute as an opt-out program. That means that all customers, if your city council votes to join and to pass an ordinance, all customers will be enrolled. They're given multiple opportunities to opt out. They can opt out at any time. It's not hard to do. In fact, there are rules about it. You can either send an email, you can call an 800 number, you can send a letter. There are lots of ways to do it that are very easy to opt out if a customer chooses.
So right now our only choice is San Diego Gas and Electric. Is that clear? That we can't opt out of. So
correct.
Right,
that's right.
Unless we're completely disconnected from the grid. Is that correct?
That's correct. And even at that point, you're probably still connected to SDG&E because you've got to have access to the transmission.
And then so JPA is a nonprofit entity. It doesn't generate profits.
It is a nonprofit public entity.
Right.
Correct.
Okay. And then so San Diego Gas and Electric, that's a utility. It's a public utility, but it's a for-profit entity. Is that correct?
Yes, they do have shareholders that they provide dividends to.
Okay, great. Any additional questions?
Just one quick follow-up question to the reserve fund. Do sure. other CCs or JPAs have caps on that?
Caps on their reserve fund?
Yeah.
At this point, most CCAs have targets that they want to meet in order to maintain fiscal viability over time
sure.
and that rate stabilization fund.
Sure.
So most of them are looking at anywhere between a 90-day and 120-day reserve fund that's equivalent to their annual operating reserve. Some of them have, I would have to go back and look if there are specific caps. What I do know is that most of them have allocated within a policy arrangement by their board mm-hmm. how much they're going to put in for the reserve, how much for programs this year, how much extra green power do we want to buy. So those are generally the buckets that you work within.
That's good to know, just because I'm concerned, like some other for-profit companies call their rainy fund is in the multi-billion dollar, you know, range, and we want to make sure that this is reinvested into the community.
Yes.
But of course, that'll be through the board, so that's important
correct.
To know. Thank you.
Yeah, just on this topic right now. I have other comments later, but do you know what does SDG&E do with their excess revenues?
I don't know. There's a representative here. She might be able to answer, or he might be able to answer.
I'd rather not.
Council questions?
Yeah, we'll just skip that now for now, and we'll find out later.
Mr. Sprague.
Oh, was that the? Are you SDG&E?
Yeah,
well, why don't we just if we have any additional questions for Ms.
Right,
Marshall,
we'll
Mr. Sprague, do you have additional questions or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Clean power. So on the program question, and this kind of ties in with a point that was made in public comment about the voting. And indeed, you know, whether it's weighted voting or not, we're going to be the tail, not the dog, on this one. One way or the other. Well, I mean, just look at the number. You just take the number of cities involved. We have one vote. Seven or eight other members on the board. That I'm not complaining about that. I'm just explaining that one way or the other, we're not going to have a majority of votes on this. So I think the question is, when it comes to looking at use of funds for what you called programs, I'm not sure what that really means. But my concern is, how do we what's to ensure that those programs benefit all of the participating agencies in the JPA, and the ratepayers in those participating agencies.
Great.
Yep.
I'll start with that, and then if you have a follow-on.
I do have, yep.
Can I start there?
Sure.
Let's start there. So I want to just reiterate, and I understand where you're coming from, but I think it's really important to understand that, and this is the case with all the CCAs we see here in California, that the very first vote is an equal vote. One member, one vote. Which means that your vote is no greater or less than the City of San Diego, Chula Vista, or any of your other members. And we have watered down and made it more difficult, frankly, to invoke that weighted vote. It's going to take three board members to get to that weighted vote. And then you have to have a two-thirds of that weighted vote. You can't have a weighted vote without an equal vote. So there are all kinds of hoops associated. Doesn't mean it won't happen, but there are many, many hoops to invoke that weighted vote. And that so far, all of the votes up and down the state have been on that one member, one vote basis. So that's an important thing, I think, to keep in mind. The second part of your question is related to programs. Some examples, I'll give you some examples and then some thoughts about how you can ensure that customers benefit. So we're seeing some really interesting programs happening. I will tell you that electric vehicles and electrification is sort of the topic du jour. I'm sure you're well familiar with all of that. What CCAs have been able to do as public government agencies is to serve as a facilitator, sort of the center hub, to access California Energy Commission grant money. There are millions of dollars out there right now to support EV infrastructure, microgrid, advanced energy work, and a myriad of other programs. The CCA can apply for that funding through the state, leverage a portion of its own funding, and then leverage with the private sector, however that works out, in order to actually implement these programs very quickly on the ground. And so the way that's happening is it's important to understand that the JPA itself, once it goes into business, is a customer-facing agency. This is not like SANDAG. This is not a policy agency. It's actually not political. You're running a business now. You are trading in the energy field, and you are offering services to your customers who have the option to opt out. So you have every incentive to offer very innovative programs. And what you can do is ask your staff to monitor and measure which customers are actually participating in those programs. And you'll be able to see those metrics through your staff on a regular basis.
Two more quick questions. And then I'll wait for the SDG&E rep to come up with the other one. The question of cost containment in terms of the JPA's operating expenses. Again, because we don't have a lion's share of the vote there. We're very frugal in Imperial Beach. We have probably by far, the smallest city staff to population ratio of any town in San Diego. My concern, I think, and I'm on the Metro Wastewater JPA, which runs a very tight budget and has minimal staff and contracts out for experts on an as-needed basis. I think the only regular staff member is the general counsel for the Metro JPA. And you've already mentioned general counsel, CEO, and CFO. And then there's the Indians who have to, didn't use that term, but then there's the working professional staff that do the procurement and work the energy side of it, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Is there a standard in terms of what that staffing ought to look like that we can expect this JPA to adhere to? And are there ways to limit that in the JPA agreement itself, so that we don't see, for example, I could foresee a situation, and I want to be paranoid about this, where a couple of the larger cities would like to add some additional staff because it helps them in some indirect ways as well.
Okay, totally valid concern. So what I will say is that there is becoming standardization now that there are 19 of these operational programs. There is some level of standardization around the functions within the JPA. You've got to have professionals running your procurement, just as you said. You need a couple of folks who are doing community outreach and enrollment. You need the CFO and the CEO and all of that. So, you know, for some of our smaller programs, it's less than five. For some of our larger programs, and you all will be a larger program, you know, staff can get up to 25 to 30 people. It really will depend on your board of directors and your CEO, and frankly, how many programs and how wide a net you cast with respect to the number of programs that you're offering. So it doesn't have to be a huge staff at all. But there are certain functions that you absolutely have to do in order to have a successful operation.
So I'm on that point. I'm not sure what the percentage of total revenue and expenses the JPA staff would be. It may be fairly small considering the volumes we're talking about, but the size of the staff can determine, it seems to me, if it's a significant portion of total cost, operating cost, might eat into that 2% benefit to ratepayers that we're talking about, which is a fairly small percentage of saving.
Yeah, so I think a couple of metrics to be aware of. Right now in the state of California, when you look at the operating budgets of the operational CCAs, and as I mentioned, there are some that are pretty small, like Solana Beach is tiny, and some that are large, LA is huge. On average, the operating expenses are running between 4% and 6% of the total budget. Less, for example, in LA, because their revenues are much larger, they get to spread their fixed costs over a larger customer base. So that percentage by ratio then goes down. But you can look at an average of 4% to 6% operating expenses. Far and away the most, the biggest expense that the JPA will have is procurement of power, and that's appropriate because that's the business that we're in. And so generally that accounts for around 85% to 90% of your operating budget will be power purchasing. Another 5%-ish for operations, and then another 5%-ish for the reserves and paying off your debt and the programs and all the other stuff that we reference. That's one way to look at.
Right. Okay, thank you. Finally, the whole idea is the ability to procure increasing amounts of renewable energy. And that's the whole point here. And to achieve 100% by 2035. Which is ambitious. Sorry? Our cap here in IB is
there are some CCAs that have established a 2025 goal. So I'm here to tell you I hope you can do it sooner.
Well, we need to do it because we understand what's going on in our macro environment, and as pointed out by one of our esteemed community members a little earlier. But the question is, where is this realistic? Where is it going to come from? And how is this production actually going to increase, the production of this kind of energy actually going to increase to enable us to meet that? I mean, we've got an absolute constraint in terms of the supply side here, and I'm just wondering how that's going to grow to meet this new JPA's goals.
Yeah. I have to tell you, I'm not seeing in the marketplace and all of the CCAs that we're working with, I'm not seeing a constraint in the marketplace. And in fact, the state of California is awash in overproduction right now of solar. So where it's at right now is the production of solar plus storage. The CCAs and all of them are out on the market at various times throughout the year with RFPs for power supply, many of them long-term. You will end up with a diversified portfolio of short-term and long-term contracts. We have simply not seen any shortage of available power and companies willing to sign counterparty agreements with CCAs.
Cost of renewables have gone down, is that correct?
Excuse me?
The cost of renewables
over time have gone down
significantly,
yes.
Is that correct?
And carbon-free power has also gone down, which is hydro in most cases.
So just
the
last little point.
Go for it.
There is also one of our esteemed members mentioned nuclear as a technically qualifying for clean or not renewable, but clean energy. Is that a likely additional source of supply
for this JPA? It's not. And the reality is the board will take that issue up right away. That issue has been raised in every city that we've been in. So that's going to be a policy matter that will come up before the end of the year. But from a practical point of view, there is no nuclear power to be procured. The utilities have it all. So it is not going to show up in your implementation plan or any of that, and your board may decide to just take it out of the JPA agreement when it first gets together.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. Mr. West, do you have any questions?
Actually, the questions were asked were actually Council Member Briggs took care of for me. It was really about the JPA foundation formula. Wait, I do have one question. So if you could kind of elaborate the difference between, like, the weighted vote that Sandag has and the weighted vote that we would have at on this JPA. Can you kind of give a little bit of a difference so our people
I can't,
know?
But Cody can.
I bet you could.
I actually can't speak to all the specifics of the Sandag vote since it's changed, but this is different in the sense that we have watered down our weighted vote here significantly more than Sandag has. When we started out negotiating this JPA, that was the first thing that came up with every single city. And so the provisions that we put in to reduce the ability of the city of San Diego to call for a weighted vote, or conversely, the provisions that allow for a weighted vote to be called are very difficult. That is different than Sandag. And it is something that when we changed that, that's something that the city of La Mesa and others said, okay, now we're comfortable with this because we feel like that makes us really comfortable. And to your point, Councilmember Spriggs, even if it was one city, one vote, you're just one of five anyway. So none of us are the majority at that point in any case. And CCAs are very different voting structures than a regional transportation agency because they're voting on power contracts. They're not voting on transportation that's being delivered to different cities and how that's being done. It's a very different and frankly less exciting a voting structure, less political. So it is very different. And we talked to a lot of cities and asked what are the votes that you're concerned about that you think weighted vote would trigger? And I would open that up to you as well. Other city council members couldn't actually think of a vote they were really concerned about, except that there might be one. So we're open to that discussion, but typically these boards and JPA boards are being very collaborative, and there are small groups like yourselves that actually get together and discuss issues and come to agreement.
And that's kind of the first initial meeting are really going to be around those discussions. That's
right.
Really going to be where we're going to lay the foundation for all the. And then I do have one last question actually not for you, but it's actually for SDG&E.
Okay.
Do you mind if we have the SDG&E rep?
Well, hold on.
Comment.
So thanks for the presentation. Obviously, experts. I really like that you mentioned transparency, the good faith weight of 49%. But this is all new to me, as well as everybody on the board and everybody in the audience. And I think treading lightly and just kind of, but what I heard tonight was reassuring. It was just reassuring. I mean, I heard a few negatives from the audience, and I can understand that, but you seem to have good comebacks. And so thank you on that. And I do want to make a comment about Doc McCoy. Doc that spoke earlier. I see Doc McCoy almost every day, and the first thing he asked me about is electricity, and then next he asked me about my dogs, and then he asked me about my family. And so, you know, this is real important to him, too. Thank you.
He's legendary.
So, did you want to have a representative from SDG&E come up?
I have one question.
You can come up and then identify yourself so we're just clear.
Don't you have one?
I think.
Please come up. Before, can you just hold on a second? I forgot to, I was remiss in not reading the public the written comments, so just bear with me. Chris and Bill Laney wrote an email on September 16th. They're opposed to the CCA. Sandra Brilhard and Michael Carey of Imperial Beach Concerned Citizens support a yes vote. And that's Dr. McCoy had an additional letter, but that was it. And Sandy Brilhard had an additional letter supporting the CCA. Thank you. Did I miss anything?
Hi, good evening, Mayor Dedina, council members, and City Manager Hall. I'm Dinah Willier. I'm with San Diego Gas and Electric, and I'm the Regional Public Affairs Manager here in the South Bay area. So if you have any questions for me, I will be glad to answer them.
Yeah. We'll just go down the
line. Yeah, we'll just go down the line. So you're a business, and of course, you have revenues. And what do you do when you have, okay, we have extra revenues. What happens to those?
Yeah, so we go through a process with the city CPUC to actually go through a process where we are allowed a certain return on investment, an authorized return on investment, and that currently is about 10% with the CPUC. Any monies that we get in terms of those returns are invested right back into our grid infrastructure. It's a highly intensive business that we're in, capital intensive business that we're in. And so we invest right back into our facilities to make sure that we are able to serve reliable service for all of our customers.
Okay, fair enough.
As far as the procurement side of it, where mm-hmm. the CCAs will be providing the energy part of it, we don't make any money on the procurement of energy itself. Whatever we contract for, any contracts that we have, any pricing that we have, is all passed through back to the customer. So we don't make any money on that part of it. We do make the money really on the delivery, the transmission and distribution part of our business.
Right, like the graphics she showed.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. And then so our goal, I think, or their goal is to get by 2025, 2030 to be 100% renewable.
There's the 2035.
2035.
Ours is 2030.
And so what is SDG&E's goal
yeah,
to reach
so
that?
Right now, we understand that the world of energy procurement is really diversifying. And so we have actually put out legislation or proposed to really get out of the procurement business. For now, we are the last source of, you know, provider, the last source provider of energy. So anybody that does want to opt out, et cetera, we will continue to provide that service. But so we do know that it is, you know, it is time for us to just continue to invest in our infrastructure to make sure that we're, again, able to provide reliable service to our customers.
So no date?
There's definitely a legislative, regulatory, et cetera,
right.
Hurdles that we need to pass. We want to make sure that all of those hurdles are looked at, you know, and scrutinized before we make this type of a leap. And so we are looking at probably a 5 to 7 year time frame, but that's just based on information that we have currently today.
To come up with a fair date of when you think you could achieve that?
So that is about our estimate. Yeah, and so what we're looking at is really some type of state entity that would provide that electric procurement service.
I want to make sure we're talking about the same thing. They're not talking about having 100% renewable within 5 or 7 years.
Oh, I know.
Oh, okay.
It's getting the plan ready.
Yeah, it's really
the plan she's talking about is for them to get out of the procurement business altogether.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, I want to make sure we're talking about the same thing.
Well, yeah. It's definitely a confusing topic, you know. Kind of shocking. Okay.
So I guess it'd be fair to say that since you're looking to jump through all these legislative hurdles to get out of the procurement business, you'd be happy to collaborate and partner with entities like CCAs and CCEs
definitely.
That are looking to provide that alternative.
Yes, most definitely. I do want to make, and I'll state again, and I stated at an earlier council meeting, that we are definitely for choice, and we support all of our cities that are looking to, you know, look to a CCA, CCE to provide that electric service or the procurement service, and we will continue to provide, you know, reliable service to our customers. And so we will probably most likely be working even more closely together with the cities because now we will have a shared customer.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, we will be working very closely with you and the JPA.
Wonderful. Thank you.
The question is exactly related to that, and that's, do you see, are there any significant issues with the CCE, CCA move that we're contemplating on the city council right now, or the general San Diego area CCA, CCE that you'd be prepared to confidentially advise us of in terms of things that you think might be concerns, issues, pitfalls from the SDG&E standpoint?
You know, and I need to go back to the comments that I made earlier, which is that SDG&E supports customer choice. So whether you stay with us as a bundled customer where we deliver both the commodity and provide the service to deliver it to you, or you choose to go with a CCA to provide your energy procurement, we support choice. So we are indifferent in terms of the choice that you make as a city.
you're indifferent, but you don't have an opinion about whether this is a good thing or not. Is that what?
I hear Cody giggling behind me because there, we do have a very strict code of conduct in terms of community choice aggregation and in terms of providing our any type of opinion as to what is a better choice or not. So it is up to the city to really make that decision. And so I go back to the fact that we do support customer choice, and that is up to your city to actually make that decision. All right.
So if this blows up in our face, I'll be giving you a call.
We'll be there to serve you, sir.
Mr. West, you have questions?
No, yeah, I just wanted to make sure that, because we put her on the spot. One of the things, Dinah's been very helpful in all of this, and SDG&E still views very much the importance of Imperial Beach as one of their customers. And as we've talked with them, one of the part of the reason there's some indifference, and I don't think she means to be indifferent, is again, SDG&E can't make money on the procurement. So it's not something that is impacting their business model. That's not where they produce their revenues. Their revenues are in the service and the distribution. So, again, she doesn't. I don't think she means to be indifferent. She just kind of is, you know, in some respects.
Yeah. Thank you very much for that clarification.
Right. One thing.
You done? Or,
one thing. Thank you very much.
All righty. Well, good.
Wait, sorry.
I'm
actually concerned about the customer that decides not to. If we go down this path, mm-hmm. and the customer stays with the SDG&E, you have a. It's been very stated in all that you are getting out of power and many levels, and I'm actually concerned about a person who is I'm sticking with SDG&E till the end. And is there a plan in place for that long-term customer?
Right. So for now, we would be your choice of last resort, is the way we state it. But also, we are looking. And it isn't established yet, right? This is all discussion. Is to have some type of state entity that would actually provide that backstop for customers who do not want to participate in a CCA. So you will never, ever have a customer that will not have the energy procurement that they need.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate you taking the time. Thank you. So now we move on to council comment. You want to start at the end, Mr. West, and we'll go this way? Is that?
Sure. I mean, I'd be more than willing to.
So just to make sure we have two jobs here to determine whether or not we want to do this, and then number two, to choose someone to sit on the JPA. Is that correct?
Yep.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
So the reality of the situation is the climate is collapsing all around. I mean, the reality is there. We are seeing it at all levels. It is no joke. It is happening, and we need to do something about it. We can't wait 5-10 years. We need to do something about it immediately. It is the only, there are very few things that keep Mark West awake at night, and this is one of them. This really makes me nervous. And I am very, you know, we've seen some of these things. I mean, the water at Scripps Oceanography found that the ocean waters in our region are the highest they'd ever seen since they started keeping track in 1916. That's a staggering. That is one of the longest ocean temperature logs that they have in the world, and they have seen the highest ocean water temperature right off our coast. So this is something we need to do it. And I believe that this program that is put in place by the city of San Diego allows us our best tool to really meet our climate action plan. Because in many ways, We've gone the extra step. We didn't wait for 2035. We immediately brought it back and made it 2030 and actually put in, we want to have some social justice for our people too. And I believe that what really sold me on this whole process was that we can provide this to our residents cheaper than what they're getting it now. And that means something to the people of Imperial Beach. We need cheaper energy. I mean, we just saw the Saudi Arabia Aramco facility get bombed. That was 5% of the oil production, and oil production overnight spiked. So I think that this is the way we need to move forward and be a part of it. And I'm going to tell a little story about when Josie and I were knocking on doors
in Imperial Beach, and I ran into this older lady who looked at me, and she goes, I know who you are. You're Mark. You live down the street from me, about two blocks down, and I really enjoy your house. You know, I've seen it. I saw, you know, you've got solar panels and all this stuff, and in fact, I just got my energy assessment score done from and got the highest grading you can get, 10%. I got a 10 out of 10, so I was very happy that. But this woman looked me straight in the eye, and she goes, you know what? That's just not realistic for me. I don't have the money to be putting on solar panels to my house. I don't have the money to put a battery on my house. I don't have the money for an electric car. These are realities of the situation that our community cannot take advantage of all of these things that make energy choices better for our communities and also better for them and cheaper. My wife and I, we don't have an electric bill. I haven't had an electric bill in years. And you know what? I'm the guy who probably could be paying a lot more for my electricity, but the choices I have made it very effective for us. So I understand that owning solar panels are out of reach for many families and communities. With community choice, everyone, no matter color, no matter what their income level is, they will have the choice to be a part of green energy. Because you know what? Green energy provides jobs, it provides a way to make our planet better, and it's the future. So I am 100% behind this. I do believe it's very important that in the future, that when we move forward on this, that I want to make sure that the JPA does address nuclear and the renewable energy credits. But I think we can work on those. I think that we can get those out. And I would also like to see the labor language a little bit tighter, because I think we can make that a better. And I would also like to recommend that the diversity of the board needs to be really important. I would like to make sure that I would recommend that Councilwoman Aguirre be the alternate to it, so we can make sure that we've got a woman of color on the JP. So that's all.
Well, I think we've heard some compelling comments tonight and reports from all sides. Some of the, I think, concerns expressed by some of our community members about whether we ought to do this or not, whether they would have the choice of staying with SDG&E or opting into the CCE, I think have pretty much been answered. Of course, any change in a big change like this is not easy, it's not comfortable. We all have, no matter what our personalities, we all have some degree of fear or resistance to change, some more than others. And so I don't really blame anybody for having reservations about this. But I think it's a question of what are the facts and what are the best courses of action that are available to us in terms of options. And we have to look at the facts, look at those options with the best information that we know and can get before us right now. And I really appreciate this public hearing tonight, because I think it has really shed a lot of good light on our choices. So I thank all of you who've spoken and who presented, you know, to us. We have two different ways of approaching climate change. One is adapting to it, and the other is trying to do something about it more or less at the source. They call that mitigation. And our climate, we're doing both of those at the same time in Imperial Beach in a very intentional way. Our climate action plan is really all about mitigation and trying to reduce our greenhouse gas footprint and other causes of global warming. And we have the ambitious targets that you all have heard about in 2030, and we're gonna try to meet that. Our community is very vulnerable to climate change. Most of you who are here know that, you know, the whole question of sea level rise is one that is an existential issue for us. I've talked about it a lot because of all the work that I'm doing on that, and other members of the council as well. we are suing the greenhouse, major greenhouse gas emitters, the major oil companies, et cetera. We're I think, the only city in San Diego County that has joined Northern California cities and counties in that effort to hold them accountable for their contributions. They're knowing, analyzed, researched, conscious contributions to global climate change, which the evidence shows, just like cigarette companies knew that their products were causing cancer, and they went ahead anyway, and they were held eventually to account for it, just like these greenhouse gas companies are going to be held for account to account for it eventually. So we're at the policy level. Your city council is doing everything we can on the mitigation front, and we are working right now on a general plan and LCP, local coastal program amendment, to do everything we can on the adaptation front as well, because we know it's coming. And if I invite anybody in this community who's concerned about either one of these aspects of either adaptation or mitigation to email us if you've got other ideas about what we ought to be doing, whether we ought to be more aggressive, etc. Let us know. Send them to the city manager, send them to us, because we are really committed to this course of action to make a difference, as much of a difference as we can in our little community on these issues, and because it's self-serving for the survival of our community as well. So I think this step is is absolutely necessary in light of who we are as a community and our vulnerabilities and what we are trying to do and what we've committed to on a policy level in so many different ways that I've just touched upon. And so I think we ought to move forward.
Just want to echo my colleagues' comments about the existential threat that is climate change. There is no doubt that it is man-made, it is here, and it is very real. Just going off of what Councilmember West said about the record water temperatures off of Scripps, I mean, last month was the hottest month on record, and we had a series of heat waves all throughout Europe that actually cost many lives. We're seeing increased intensity and storm events. We are living here at the front line of it all with sea level rise. During the last King Tides events, we had over $10,000-$15,000 in damages or in cleanup that cost us, the city, a working class community that is already constantly being pummeled by cross-border pollution. I mean, it is said that good governance is looking in the future 7 generations ahead, right? Well, I say this is 1 generation ahead of us. According to the United Nations IPCC report, we're 10 years away from catastrophic, you know, consequences. We just saw the biggest glacier, right, melt, 160 billion ton glacier. So I think that we need to do what we can, and I think this is the way to do it. We've already implemented our very ambitious CAP goals. I'm very actually thankful to the city of San Diego and the other cities that have invited us to join. I'm very excited about having this opportunity, not just because of the environment and because of the climate crisis, but also because it'll give our community options and hopefully reduce their bills. Because I, for one, I'm not a homeowner, unfortunately. I'm a renter. Well, we'll see. Cool. But I'm a renter, and I live in a community. And the one common complaint that I always get from my neighbors is, sorry, Dinah. So my bill, my electricity bill keeps going up, you know. So I feel their pain, too. So I really like that we're going to have the option to give our community you know, lower costs in energy procurement. So moving forward, I do want to make sure that we address and improve some of the aspects relating to labor and workforce provisions. I want to make sure that those are improved, and happy to help Councilmember West in that effort. And finally, I just want to give us a shout out to the Climate Action Campaign for all of their tireless work. They're climate warriors. It's so impressive the work that you've done, and I'm getting everybody on board. So that's it for me.
Mr. Patton.
So from what I understand, the city of San Diego, Chula Vista, Encinitas, they've probably had they've probably had a lot of meetings already on this. This is our first one. And for the fact that we're being invited in, to me it seems like a gift, because they didn't have to invite us. So we could have just been outsiders, but actually how it works out is right now we're riding on all of their hard work and being part of this. So I look at it as a gift. And also the fact that we have options. I love options. I never like just one. You have to do it this way. If I want to stick with SDG&E, I personally might. Or I may go with the other option. But I do like that option, and I think our citizens would like it too. So I'm for this. And I think Councilwoman Aguirre, just for her, she's on the council for sure another 3 more years. And I think anybody that takes this role needs to be very knowledgeable. They just couldn't be on it for 1 year. They need to be on it for a while to really know the nuts and bolts. So that's all I have.
Great. Thanks, everybody. I want to thanks for all the community feedback. And then Cody and Sean, thank you so much. And then thank you so much as well as PG&E. So there's a long history in this country of breaking up monopolies. And so I like the idea of consumer choice. Having visited a communist country like Cuba, where they don't have choice, it's really important to make sure that our residents have consumer choice. So I like the way SDG has framed that. It's nice to have, that's how the free market works, right? You don't just have one entity you have to give your money to. You have, as a consumer, you can have choice. So I think that's really important. Number two, we talk about emissions, it's air pollution. San Diego has the sixth worst air pollution in the country. And the reality is, the more fossil fuels we burn, the dirtier the air becomes, and the more our kids get sick. That's really, really important to reduce that. So we just need to reduce air pollution. That's reducing carbon emissions. Number three, like Doc McCoy and Mr. West, I'm a big fan of Rocky Mountain National Park. And although you both grew up in the Front Range, and Mr. Doc McCoy is a legendary mountain climber. You probably both know Mount Ypsilon in Rocky Mountain National Park. It's 13,000 feet. I've been climbing it for about 30 years with my wife's family and my kids now. Kids are young. We're up at 13,000 feet this year, just recently, looking down towards the Poudre River, which goes north towards Wyoming. And it's a south to north flowing river, where it's at least where the watershed starts. And all we saw were brown trees. I've been going there for 30 years. 30 years ago, you didn't see brown trees. 75% of the trees on the north slope or the western slope of Rocky Mountain National Park are dying or dead because of pine bark beetle. Basically, the temperatures have gotten so hot at high elevations that basically the trees, these beetles no longer die in the winter, and so they're killing all the trees. It's one of the most astounding things I've ever seen, because I've been going there. When I started going there 30 years ago with my wife's family, I was just graduated from UCSD, and you didn't see any. I was in the 80s. You didn't see any brown trees. And then over the years, we kept seeing more and more and more. And then the other thing that freaked me out this year was that we're at 11,000 feet at 8 o'clock in the morning to start our hike, and it was hot. It was hot. Never felt that in 30 years. It's just different. And, the temperatures at high elevations are the hottest they've ever been. So you really see the extremes at the high elevations, especially in the tundra, where it was being really impacted, where animals have nowhere to go. So really interesting and really impacted me personally. But I like the idea that we're going to do everything we can to reduce emissions and reduce air pollution, and more importantly, give our residents an opportunity to exercise their freedom of choice, as Devo once said, or once sang. Anyway, I may be the only council member ever to quote Devo in the Imperial Beach City Council meeting, so my street cred on that one is super high. Anyway, with that, I would like to entertain a motion to adopt resolution number 2019-8087.
So moved.
And then what do we have to do?
I just want to make sure that we understand. So the resolution tonight allows us to join the JPA. That's the first part of it. And then the ordinance that follows that, which is ordinance 2019-1187, then enables the CCA program. So just want to make sure that you understand there's two votes here.
Okay.
And before we do that, I just want, just from the inside, I wanted to thank these guys. I need to maybe expand on what Councilman Patton said. There's been a lot of work done, a whole bunch of work done, and at the very end, they invited us to come in and join them, and we haven't had to do a lot of that work or expend, frankly, a lot of city money to do a lot of the studies that they have done. So we really appreciate that, and they've been very open and given us a lot of information. So I just wanted to do that.
Rock stars. Sure. Yeah. We're voting on the...
Motion carried unanimously. Ordinance number 2019-1187, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Imperial Beach, authorizing and enabling the implementation of a community choice aggregation program.
And enabling the implementation by title only, waive reading in full, and set the ordinance for adoption in a subsequent city council meeting. Is there a motion?
Second.
Please vote. And now we're going to do the recommendation.
Motion carried unanimously.
Okay. Now is there a motion to have Mark West be the JPA representative and Paloma Aguirre as the alternate?
Second.
Please vote.
Motion carried unanimously.
Great, thank you. Moving on. Item 5.1, consideration of elections code section. Are we taking a break? Okay, we'll take a 5-minute break. Thank you so much for coming. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
5 minutes, I'm counting. The magic clock is running. Thank you.
start the meeting in 2 minutes. 2 minutes. 1 minute and 46 seconds.
Don't wait.
It was up a minute ago.
Now we have item 5.1, consideration of elections. By the way, everybody, when I say 5 minutes, I count the time. So we start, I start on time. You can swim a 350 in 5 minutes. I could swim.
Yep.
But not a 500. My kid's good. In consideration of election code section 9212, report on 2017 citizen initiative regarding cannabis activities and consideration of resolutions by the city council to adopt the initiative as is, or to put the initiative on an upcoming ballot, call next regular municipal election and request consolidation with statewide election. Assistant City Manager Dish will give the report, followed by City Attorney Lyon. Correspondence from Council Member Spriggs and from Sinara Velasquez were submitted to City Council's last-minute agenda information. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor and members of Council. So as you had indicated, this is the consideration of a report that was requested 2 meetings ago by the City Council on this particular citizens initiative. Just to ground everybody, just a short history. The City Council deliberations on city ordinances and the evolution of cannabis petition occurred generally at the same time. And Council Member Aguirre had requested at the last meeting that we provide a bit of a history, and I'll get into that in a moment. So the petition was submitted to the city, and it was rejected to state law requirements. That rejection was upheld by Superior Court. The City Council proceeded to adopt a cannabis ordinance, and I'll get into the elements of what that looks like currently. During that time, then, the decision of the Superior Court was actually overturned by the Court of Appeals. And then the petition submitted to the County Register of Voter confirmed that there were enough signatures, and so then it led us down to this sort of election process that we're into right now. As the mayor had indicated, there was some last minute information submitted by Council Member Spriggs, and he had augmented the history relative to one of the elements where there was a potential to modify the existing ordinance and allow for two immediately without some other provisions. That was actually at the June 19th City Council meeting. That proposal was rejected during that meeting. So where are we at currently? The existing city regulations allow one cannabis retail outlet in the community, and there is an option to allow a second one at a future date, provided certain criteria are met. Staff is currently in the process of reviewing applications. None have been issued at this time. The proposed addition, the proposed initiative would allow for additional and a wider variety of cannabis businesses than are currently permitted. The current ordinance allows for only retail. The initiative proposes retail, manufacturing, and lounges. During the August 21st council meeting, the city council had requested a report in accordance with the election codes, and that is what we're discussing this evening. The city council will receive this report, and then there are two options that they have to choose from, and we'll go over those in a moment. But again, as I alluded to at the beginning, there are some informational items that were requested. Councilmember Aguirre at the last meeting had said, hey, could you provide in this report sort of a summary of the history? And so the graphic in front of you this evening shows that there is a wide variety of steps here. And I won't go into each one of those little blue boxes that are kind of in the shape of a feather. We can start, you know, there was pre-Prop 64, which allowed for, and the city had an ordinance in place that addressed cannabis to a certain degree. Prop 64 was passed, and that authorized the adult use of recreational marijuana. Following that, and again, just hitting some of the highlights, the city had prepared a moratorium and then formed an ad hoc committee. That ad hoc committee consisted of Councilmember West and former council member Lori Bragg. And as you can see, there was a wide variety of process that was held throughout that, a lot of research, a lot of outreach meetings. It culminated into an ordinance that was adopted that I had mentioned some of the elements previously, and that's where we're at currently. One of the elements as a part of that sort of outreach that was done was during one of the outreach meetings, there was a survey, and I won't go through and look at all of these, but some of the salient points here are, and this was sort of a theme that was held by the ad hoc cannabis committee, and it's really embodied in that first question is, should businesses be allowed to operate in Imperial Beach? Yes, and actually the second one was really the salient point, if it were to locate in Imperial Beach, should these regulations be created locally by the community? And again, you can see the result there was 91%. So again, as indicated earlier, there were some last minute comments received from Councilmember Spriggs, and those are offered in here. And what it does is it sort of highlights some of the data from the factual account within the within the proposed petition, and this is based upon the number of sort of cannabis uses that could be located within the community based upon only separations. And again, some other ones, again, just for the edification, and we would submit this to you as a part of the record and as a part of the report for your consideration in anticipation of the two options that you have to consider this evening. So what are the initiative elements? So there are three types of uses that are permitted under the initiative. There are cannabis storefronts, which are retailers. There's cannabis manufacturing, and that manufacturing is limited to edibles. And those would be non-retailers, so it'd be sort of like a wholesaler. And then there are cannabis lounges that are being permitted. The permit approval process would be by a conditional use permit. The existing permit approval process is what's called a regulatory safety permit, and it's sort of a binary review process where if an application comes in, we review it. Again, I'm truncating this process. Staff reviews it in accordance with the regulations on file, and if they meet those criteria, then they would become eligible. If there's more than one eligible site and one eligible application, then there's a random selection process, i.e. a lottery, that would select the very first retailer in the city. And as I had briefly mentioned, we're in the process of reviewing those. As a matter of fact, today was a deadline for a resubmittal for those applications that are in process currently. There's also a provision in the petition where cannabis manufacturing precludes disclosing the location. I offer that because procedurally that gets difficult to administer because that's how we generate our notice requirements based upon the location of certain businesses from a conditional use permit. The existing ordinance has a residential buffer. The petition does not have a residential buffer. Again, the potential allowance under this petition, and again, we just took a look at what the separation requirements are, and we derived this. We used the ESRI product, our GIS, to create the boundaries, and I'll show the maps in a moment, to create the boundaries where these proposed uses could go. And then the GIS used a randomized algorithm that we ran a couple of different times to determine what these numbers were. So again, the computer sort of identified the separate, and the only element that we could use was the 900-foot separations. And in some cases, there are 600-foot separations. These vary. And I have a map for each one of the types of use and a composite that I'll show in a moment. So here's the first map. And just to explain for the audience and everybody, this red line constitutes the existing CMU1 zone district within the city. And this green line here constitutes the existing CMU2 zone. And then there are different buffers that are identified per the petition where a cannabis retailer use in this instance could not locate. So when those buffers are outlaid here, you can see that the zone districts that would allow it, and again, in this case, CMU1 and CMU2, only have a sliver of an area right here by the white area, the non-colored area, that would be an eligible location or a potential eligible location for a retailer under the petition. And then the area outlined in red along Palm Avenue, SR 75, those areas that are not colored are also eligible sort of receiving areas for a retailer. Cannabis manufacturing, again, the same sort of process that we went through. For this particular use, the petition identified the CMU1 zone as the only eligible zone district, and then it had identified these separations and these buffers, and that yields the area, again, in this area that is not colored within the red dashed line. The third use that proposed in the petition are cannabis lounges, and the zone districts within which those are proposed to be located per the petition are in the CMU1 zone, again, outlined here in red, and then the CMU2 zone, outlined here in green. And those areas that are not colored, so again, this entire area, and then these areas outside of this buffer would be eligible receiving areas. So then the very last map that I'll show before I turn it over to City Attorney Lyons is a composite identifying the potential locations of the various uses that are proposed. And so again, I want to be clear that the only element that we used was the separations per the ordinance, because there are so many factors involved in terms of if one didn't locate here and it located here, that would modify that. And I think that, and I manifest this in the staff report that was written and provided to you. There was a speaker, I believe they identified themselves as the individual who wrote the petition. It indicated, I think, a range of up to 8 potential uses, 2 manufacturing, 3 lounges, and 3 retail fronts is what they had anticipated based upon various factors. But again, the only factor that we used was that randomized algorithm based upon the geography identified here and the petition separations. And so you can see here there would be lounges potentially located along Seacoast Drive, Old or Classic Palm, as some call it, one potential retailer, and then again the balance of the uses along this area. And so with that, I'm going to have Jen talk about the options.
So now that the council has received the report that's allowed or authorized pursuant to the elections code, the two options before the council that must be taken tonight, one of the two options must be taken tonight. So option one is to approve the ordinance or the initiative exactly as it's drafted as an ordinance. The initiative, if that were the case, could only be changed by going to the voters if the council adopted the initiative as is. The ordinance would then need to be submitted to the Coastal Commission
before it could go into effect. And if council wanted to choose this option, we would just suggest a special meeting be set within 10 days to present the actual ordinance to the council. The other option that council is allowed to take tonight is to place the initiative on the ballot. It would be, the council would be placing the item on the November 3rd, 2020 ballot. If it's approved by a majority vote of the citizens, then again, it would go to the Coastal Commission for approval before it goes into effect. If the voters were to reject it, the city's current regulations would remain in place. And so to place it on the November 2020 ballot, council must consider adopting three resolutions tonight. And those resolutions would call the election, place it on the ballot, set forth the typical election procedures, provide for ballot arguments, and authorize the mayor to file a written argument on the council's behalf if desired. So just requesting action from the council tonight is to select one of these options pursuant to the elections code. One of these options has to be acted upon by the council tonight. Because if, as you recall at the last meeting about a month ago, there were three options. One was to request the report, and that's what the council did, but now the time is up to make one of these decisions.
And I think this goes without saying, but just to remind everyone, we are in this position because we're compelled to be here. This is a court action, and the judge has let us know that we need to take one of these options. We can either put it on the ballot or adopt the petition as is. So one of the options is not to just vote this down. That is not an option that the council has tonight. And just wanted to clarify that for you and for everyone in the audience, that these are your two options.
So again, we're restricted to 2 minutes. Please let us know what option you'd like us to pursue if you're a local resident. Anyway, with that, Sonara, I know that you wanted to have someone else join with someone else, but I'm just having everybody speak for 2 minutes. So you're first. Are you here, Sonara Velasquez? Sonara, will be followed by Dallin Young. Did you want to speak still, Dallin? Okay. And then I'm going to call in Jessica Melfresh. I can't remember. I can't read that. Yeah, Jessica, be next. Okay.
Okay. So I'd like to address some of the comments made by Mayor at the last two council meetings ago when this was discussed. He said, essentially, the marijuana industry is acting like a cartel, throwing their sort of monopoly around with unlimited cash resources and picking on Imperial Beach. They're essentially blackmailing us to doing what they want, as opposed to having our citizen-driven public official approach, which represents a world of people, to carry out their designs for economic development. So it's really bad. It's really, really, really bad. And it's unfortunate that the marijuana industry is picking on a small city like Imperial Beach.
And I totally stand by those comments.
Picking by...
I'll double down on it.
From kids. And it's really despicable in the worst possible way. So they have no integrity, no morals, no ethics, no values, and are anti-democratic. First, let's address the idea that unlimited amounts of cash was spent on this initiative. It was extremely economic to qualify. We did not hire a professional signature gathering firm because IB residents themselves gathered the signatures. IB residents were eager to sign. When an initiative is popular, it is not expensive. For comparison, we spent less than half of what the mayor spent on his own election campaign in 2018. And no one is accusing him of being associated with big moneyed cartel interest, and neither are we. The mayor referred to a monopoly in his remark. A monopoly is exactly what the current ordinance at IB is designed to create. The regulations currently on the books allow for one dispensary, and the ordinance was written with so many restrictions that approximately four parcels qualify to operate. And one of those will be given the monopoly. Not a single application has been qualified, so what has actually been achieved to date is a complete ban on access. The comparison to a cartel was also very offensive. What we are trying to do is create a regulated market to combat the black market, to combat cartels. Mayor Danino, we are not bad people. We, like you, want to make a better world and a better community. You may not agree with our priorities, our policies, and our tactics, but this disagreement does not make us bad. It just means we have a different idea of how to make things better. Your comments were extremely demeaning, divisive, and disrespectful, and did nothing to contribute to the healthy, respectful dialogue that we all desire and the residents of this city deserve. We have different ways of trying to better the world. It doesn't mean that we don't want to do it. We respect that you're right to disagree with us, but let us stick to the issues of our disagreement. Defamatory remarks have no place in this debate. Thank you.
Jessica? Sorry, I can't read it.
It's all right. Some days I wake up and can't pronounce my own last name, too. My name's Jessica McElfresh. What I would like to focus on is sort of the numbers that this could potentially bring. We do agree that one hypothetically is not enough. And clearly the voters who signed this petition somewhat agreed with us as well. I know it's always difficult when you have these maps and we put them in. Your staff does their best. They put things out there. They put the barriers on them. And of course, we cannot know. However, there were some materials submitted that started talking about 30. We just don't really understand where that number could have conceivably come from. When we have looked at this and stretched it out, we see a maximum of basically 3 retailers, 3 possible lounges, and a maximum of 2 commercial kitchens. And I honestly think that that's unlikely to be achieved. Several years ago, the city of Lemon Grove predicted they would have 16 sites following a ballot initiative. They've ultimately wound up with no more than 2. The reality is there are, just because a parcel may be zoned, may be work, does not mean that a landlord's going to have room, doesn't mean they're going to want to rent, doesn't mean they don't have an existing tenant. The practical reality is we may be talking about as few as maybe 2 sites, actually. We've mapped it that way and had it come out that way. So, of course, you're entitled to go with your numbers and consider them how you like, but I do think that there's also the possibility that these higher numbers are just not probable, given the reality of how these things tend to play out. Thank you.
Thank you. Landon Young, followed by Becca Taylor, followed by Rosie Covarrubias, followed by Eileen Hinault.
Good evening. I'll stay brief just for the sake of everyone's time. A citizen-driven initiative is not blackmail. In fact, it is democracy. The survey conducted at a public workshop on which the council based its original recommendations included only 71 responses. A survey this small is not representative of the will of the voters and residents of Imperial Beach. Luckily, the residents of IB have recently voted on whether to allow legal marijuana. The voters of Imperial Beach voted for Proposition 64 to allow adult-use marijuana at the third highest rate of any city in the county and at the highest rate of any city in South County. Residents of Imperial Beach, when presented with the full text of this initiative, as well as the impartial title and summary created by the city attorney on top of every signature sheet, were eager and willing to sign the petition to allow for local marijuana businesses. And this November, they will get
Hey, I'm Becca Taylor. I'm with the Association of Cannabis Professionals, and I'm encouraging you to vote yes on the initiative as is. So that Landon already mentioned the 60% on Prop 64, so I'll skip down to Surge. We would love for consumers to have a choice here in Imperial Beach and agree that there should not be a monopoly on this industry as the current ordinance is set up. Not everyone can afford delivery from Chula Vista or San Diego or has a way to get to the storefronts out there. And last but not least, this initiative would allow edible manufacturers, dispensaries, and cannabis lounges 900 feet from schools, playgrounds, daycares, and each other. I mention that because it's important, because that means it would limit the number of dispensaries or storefronts that would actually qualify at the end of the day. So that is it. Again, I encourage you guys to vote yes on this as is. Please.
Thank you, Rosie Covarrubias. Rosie here. Followed by Eileen. And then John Becker.
I will try to talk fast. I have lived here in IB for many years, and I don't agree with the dispensaries. There are enough drugs, medical and illegal, already in reach. The city is not large like New York City. Legal drugs are a stone's throw away to obtain. Neighbors have obtained it. There's no need to add dispensaries to IV unless it's for putting profit over the community under the guise of benefiting everyone overall on what is ultimately all about money. If not, then why not go back to when the drugs were all over Seacoast? Is the difference that illegal money was not benefiting the council? Don't use the word legal as an excuse to put back what was already cleaned up. Is it to tailor to tourists coming into the city as a convenience versus community concerns? Everyday IBians, laymen who have been productive members and helped the city grow for decades. When greed oversteps the community, then you essentially have killed the community, are in the process of pushing everyday people out, by rising rent costs and everything that comes along with it for money to tailor to a tourist town. To use a token of building a few low-income housing on this is for a select few, as it will be a select few at the expense of having this product more readily available. The police have their hands full already with the alcohol issues here, and this is also what our kids will be seeing. I hate to think of the council falling to profits over the community. If you allow a company to financially bully you, who and what will be next? Knocking on our door due to the weakness of saying no. I want to tell my daughter, say no to drugs, except when money is involved. And it's us that are counting on you to protect and hear our voice, so she doesn't have to see this in addition to the ocean and the beautiful community that we have here. This is a very special community, and she wants to live here and grow here and be a homeowner here and not have it like all the other communities. And I really want to keep that versus the marijuana. I also suffer from autoimmune disease, so I understand the importance of having medical use for marijuana. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Eileen Hino. Eileen will be followed by John Becker, Leonard Miranda, and Mary Hensley.
Hi, thank you for allowing me to speak. My name is Eileen Hino, and I live on Florida Street here in Imperial Beach. And I'll try to be brief. We have just 2 minutes. You said, what do I want? I think I want what you said regarding Devo, freedom of choice. I think everybody thinks that the idea of having just one dispensary, it's a monopoly. It's not going to make things affordable for people. So it just doesn't seem right to me. I also want to correct some things that I've heard. I heard it said that the community doesn't care about this issue. I think, in fact, the community does. When I walked the streets and talked to people, it was clear that most people were in favor of access, but we're a working community, and so people don't know that this whole thing is being revisited. I didn't know until yesterday when Becca let me know that there was going to be a meeting, and I care, and I think most of you know, I have two children. My older son does not use any cannabis, and I know that for sure because the Navy checks him regularly. My younger son has a developmental disability. He has severe autism with sensory processing disorder. So he has used cannabis, and it really helped us. We tried a variety of pharmaceuticals that did not work, had terrible adverse effects, and when he used the cannabis, it helped him. We're not really using it much anymore because he's about to turn 20 next month, and the worst period for us was during adolescence, where that really increases a lot of the severity of symptoms. So now he only uses a little bit of CBD, no THC at all anymore, except for really big things like when he got his wisdom teeth out this summer. So anyway, thank you all very much.
Thank you, Eileen. John Becker.
Good evening again. I'm John Becker, 1233 Loudon Lane. I spoke with you earlier, but today, tonight, right now, support option two, support option two, support option two, support option two. Keep the work that you have done over the last 2 years in place. We have options. People have delivery to their homes anytime they want it. It's from multiple sources. There's no such thing as monopoly. We're too small to have such a thing as monopoly. Option two, option two, option two, option two. Also, the third point, the numbers I got earlier were right from the paper and it said net income.
Mr. Becker, you're trying to make your point. This was another issue. Thank you. Appreciate it, though. Mr. Miranda? We saw you, don't worry, waving your newspaper.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak on this item. I think this is an item worth walking back. I think this is a cookie cutter approach by the cannabis industry that they've been using throughout the state as far as kind of strong arming cities into this new legislation. And I believe there's a lot of misinformation out there, and some people have conflated scientific information from marketing and basically commercializing the lack of harm that marijuana is, and when in fact it's creating a lot of harm. Everywhere dispensaries have been put in,
there's been an increase in crime. When a dispensary goes in, two illegal dispensaries go in and they try to undercut the business. Most recreational users go to the illegal dispensaries, so the money is not being realized as far as tax revenue. So there's a lot of data out there, a ton of data, and I think we should walk this back, go to the voters for 2020, and then set up a citizens advisory committee, a cross-section of the citizens, let them bring the data to the table, and then wrestle with the data, and then let the data drive the decision. I'm just going to highlight one little point here. This is from the most recent Sandex study. This is from July of this year, just a month ago. Recent drug use at a 19-year high. Almost three in every five youth, that's 58%, interviewed in juvenile hall. Three of five, 58% interviewed in juvenile hall, admitted and were tested. This is not even just self-reporting, that they have used all three of the gateway drugs, alcohol, tobacco, and marijuana. Here's the scarier part, and this is the good marketing by the cannabis industry. Marijuana remains the drug of choice of youth interviewed, with 55% testing positive at the time of these interviews and testing. It's a 19-year high. Only 11% of the youth thought marijuana could be harmful to someone, compared to 33% believing alcohol is bad for you and 60% think tobacco is bad for you. 11% believe marijuana is not, 11% think marijuana is bad for you, meaning 89% think it's okay. And some of us adults think it's okay. So that messaging that's bringing this marijuana out of the shadows into the marketplace for recreation, which is a misnomer and a bad term, I think we need to walk this back and bring data to the table.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rondo. Mary Hensley?
Yeah.
Remember, please let us know what you'd like us to do.
Okay. No. And I would like to say one other thing.
No on what?
No on the cannabis of any type. Of course, we can't do that, but I want, like John Becker said, like this other man said, like Rosie said,
Ms. Hensley,
everyone I have talked to.
Tell us.
Okay,
what you like.
I'm telling you. I'm just saying that I agree with all of them, and I just want to say, do we want to look like Chula Vista? And I'm so sick and fed up with hearing the dishonesty of conflating medical marijuana usage with recreational. You want to get the pot, get your finger, press the buttons, and it'll be delivered right to your door. And I'm sick and tired of hearing, well, I need my marijuana because I can't function. All right, it's corrupt. It's greed, it's graft, and it's total dishonesty.
Great, thank you. Is it Glendon Velasquez? I'm sure I'm reading the name correctly. Oh. Say your name correctly? Is it Glendon?
Yeah.
Can you speak into the microphone, please?
My name is Glendon Velasquez, and in 1958, I drove into town, and this has been my home for 61 years. I arrived on my 24th birthday, and yesterday was my birthday again. You know, they roll around a lot faster the older you get. But after we had a delicious dinner at the Brigantine, we walked out on the pier and enjoyed the sunset. And my son said to me, Mom, this place has really changed a lot since I grew up here and I was in high school. We can go to the beach now. It's clean and safe. And look at all the new businesses that have come into town. The reason I'm bringing this up is that Imperial Beach means a lot to me. This is my home. And we've seen a lot of changes over the years. And all of them, almost all of them, have been really good. You know, just updating Seacoast Drive has been such an asset to our city. There's just so many good things that have happened to us lately, but I don't think it's bringing marijuana into town. And over the years, good things have happened to us. And I was raised in Missouri, where we didn't have an ocean. It was 2,000 miles away from me. We did have a lot of ponds, and we lived about 40 miles from the beautiful Lake of the Ozarks, but we didn't have what we have here that draws so many tourism into our town. The tourists love it here. There's plenty of places to stay, places to eat, things to enjoy.
Mrs. Velasquez, can you wrap it up? Just maybe you could let us know what you'd like us to do. If you could let us know what you'd like us to do, there are two options to...
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
There are two options for us to pursue. One is to allow the initiative to proceed forward, or one is to have put it on the ballot. Have you decided what you'd like us to do?
Well, I guess the way to do it is put it on the ballot so we can vote against it, because we're not people that just waltzed into town last week. We've been homeowners here for all of these years. My husband graduated from Mar Vista, my kids did, and I don't see anything good coming from any more of these storefronts. And I hope that you will sincerely give this a lot of your attention and your prayerful thought and vote no on this issue.
Great. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Steve Fetterman, we didn't forget you, Steve.
Steve Fetterman, 941 2nd Street. Thanks so much for your service. So I voted for Prop 64 to legalize marijuana. Not because I think it's good, I think it's not good, but I'm against prohibition, and I'm just tired of seeing black men locked up in cages, quite frankly, for things. But make no mistake about it, this is a business run by dopers for dopers, period. There's really no question about it. What this group is doing is absolute extortion. They know this community is vulnerable, and it's really beyond the pale that they will come here. They absolutely know it. We're still part of the 51st District. We got 15% unemployment rate. We have high school dropout rates. Our kids are absolutely vulnerable to this type of crap. Our school boards are corrupt, stealing from the community. So we have to do everything we can. And I think our options are limited. I would say go ahead and put it on the ballot, quite frankly. This town has worked so hard, you know, getting rid of their drug issue between the 80s and 90s. A bunch of white people, kids coming in here and saying that they've had problems smoking dope is really beyond the pale. It's just so silly. I can't even believe that. I'm so angry thinking about it. So I know the options are limited, but I would hopefully ask, there was one other point that I want to say. The first thing you come into this town now is a big billboard that says buy dope. You can't walk down Seacoast Drive now without smelling it. So I understand that the sheriff's department's limited. They can't, there's no way to monitor this. I get it. I made a decision to live by the near the beach, and I understand that with comes a certain amount of things I'm just going to have to accept. But I would hope that the council keeps a really close eye on the situation. Don't allow these people to extort us. We have to play our role here as a community as well. I will do everything. I will write checks if I have to, but we'll do everything to make sure that these people don't come in here and ruin the lives of our community and our kids.
To be clear, you want us to put it on the ballot. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Fetterman. Lisa Thomas, and then Erica, you're last.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Council. My name is Lisa Thomas, 753 10th Street, Imperial Beach. As far as marijuana is concerned, I don't have a preference either way. I personally don't consume it. I know people who do. That's their choice. But I would really like to hope that this initiative will be put on the ballot. I also encourage you to include an implementation of a substantial tax on the ballot, on all ballot measures. It's my understanding that Imperial Beach will only benefit financially from this via the application fees and the business license fees. That's not enough. If we have to have this, which we have to have this, we have to make money on it. I mean, we're broke, you know? So this will, by putting a substantial tax on the legal marijuana, that will at least give us a way to benefit from it as a city. That's all.
Thank you. Erica Lowry.
Okay, I'm last. Why not? As kids, we are taught that peer pressure is bad and that we should ignore it or fight it. Today, peer pressure comes in the form of either lawsuits or initiatives being forced onto the election ballot that has already been decided. I'm here to encourage our city leaders to be just that, leaders. Don't be pushed into this initiative that would tear down our city that we are all working so hard to build up. I would like to see you stand your ground. As such, I would encourage the city to, one, keep the existing ordinance in place. Also inform the community of the existing ordinance. Two, allow the initiative on the ballot for the 2020 election. 3, include our current ordinance on that same ballot. I would like to see our leaders take a role in outreach to their neighbors and friends. You have been elected. You have the contacts. Show the community why this is not necessary. Show that we already have something in place. Show the leadership that your community has given to you is not in vain. I feel that there's a lot of misunderstanding in regards to the citizens initiative, specifically the lounges and the number of storefronts and lounges and manufacturing sites and the definitions of each. If you follow some of the commentaries on social media, there's a lot of pushback and questions when it comes to this issue. I worry that if this initiative is so open-ended that Palm Avenue will look like parts of 3rd Street in Chula Vista with green plus signs being waved around every few blocks. This is not what Imperial Beach is striving for. We are looking upwards and not to this shade of green.
Thank you so much. Any additional public comments? I want to make sure I haven't missed any.
No, Mr.
We didn't miss anybody out there, right? Is that correct? Right. I'm now closing the public comment period. It's time for council discussion. I don't have any, but you want to start, Mr. Patton? We'll just go down the line.
So the last council meeting when we voted 1 versus 2 storefronts to start off, when I voted that, along with the majority of us, I received 8 cards from residents from Imperial Beach thanking me for doing that, and that took a lot of time for them to write those cards, and that meant a lot to me. Gwendolyn, is that your name? Gwendolyn? Glendon. To me, she said it all. She's been here for a long time, and she doesn't want to see it, and I want to be here for a long time. I don't want to see numerous storefronts, fronts, and lounges, and anything out of the ordinary to ruin Imperial Beach's nice vibe. I think I'd move if that happened, because it's not why I live here. I live here for this nice Southern California beach that we love. And then Steve said we're vulnerable, and I'm going to disagree. I think we're strong and small, but we're not vulnerable. I think we're strong. We're definitely strong, but maybe that we might be seen as small and vulnerable. I don't see them going to Coronado, because that discussion wouldn't happen. So they're like, we'll just hit IB. So in that regard, I agree with you. But long story short, I think we need to put this in option 2 and put it on, and let the voters decide.
Great, thank you. Councilmember McGarry, did you want to speak? Or
I have some concerns with the initiative as it is being proposed, just because going back to the information that Steve shared with us earlier about the interest in having residential buffers was voted favorably and during the ad hoc outreach that took place some time ago. I also would be favorable to taxing the establishments at a much higher rate to offset some of the regulatory costs that we would incur, and that was pretty well supported by the community. So at this point, I am inclined to support putting it on the ballot for those reasons.
Great, thank you. Mr. Spriggs?
Just a quick data point, and then a quick thought. In the city's staff report, it mentions the potential for 8 that the Association of Cannabis Professionals mentioned. Steve Dush mentioned it in his report, his verbal report. The GIS number of 30 may be high, but my sense is that the truth is probably somewhere in between there. But even if we take the figures from ACP, the three consumption lounges, the three retail outlets, and two manufacturing outlets. And we look at those three consumption lounges, which is really the big unknown. His report, the city's report, says that there's not that much experience in the U.S. with consumption lounges, but that San Francisco has seven consumption lounges. Now, with San Francisco's population, that's one lounge per 126,000 people. With our population, three lounges, 27,000, that's one for every 9,000 Imperial Beach residents, men, women, and children. So I think that speaks for itself in terms of the density of just that one aspect, taking ACP's own numbers, that gives us a sense as to what we would be in for if this initiative were to pass. But as I said at our last meeting on this, I think this needs to go to the voters and let them decide. This is, this is really, I think, our very best choice. And I would say this, if it does pass, and I like Erica Lowry's comments in terms of the way we might want to consider putting it on the ballot with our own existing ordinance as a on the ballot as well, so that people can see what the comparison is. Possibly by that time we'll have two operating already, depending on how the licensing process goes. But if for some reason the ballot initiative succeeds and is voted in by a majority of voters, and we're likely to have multiple outlets here, I think then we need to reconvene as a city council and consider a tax measure. I really think that would make a lot of sense. It doesn't make necessarily a lot of sense for just one or two, but if we're talking about eight or more as potentially in this town, then we need to make sure that we derive enough revenue to handle all of the unforeseen consequences, including enforcement and oversight. So I say let's put it on the ballot, and if it passes, then we need to consider a tax measure.
Mr. Roth.
Yeah. Steve, Mr. Dish, thank you very much for putting all this information together. I think it's really good to just see, like what we did at the ad hoc, is to see all the work that was put in to really get us here. And it was really your herringbone that you put together really shows all those, and it makes it. I mean, I think the biggest takeaway that we had was that the people of Imperial Beach wanted us to control this. They wanted us to be the to put this in, make sure it didn't go out. And I think that if we go with option two, we're putting it in the control of the people. So I think that that's what the city of Imperial Beach is wanting us to do. And I think that that is the right thing to do. I would also like to say that I agree. I think I would make sure that that our competing ordinance is put on there as well, so we can have some checks and balances on there. And if we're going to do a tax, we might as 2020 is probably the right time to do the tax instead of wait until after we get it. I think we should be moving forward with that at that point. So I am not, I think we should just roll all these three into one big thing, competing ordinance, tax, and put it on. So that's all I have.
But that's not written.
Yeah, it's the third option. Sure. Yeah, well, we can.
Yeah,
we can
that.
Look
yeah,
those
I'm just
measures
saying.
Will be coming back to the count. We'll be having a discussion piece, and those will be drafted. They don't have to be submitted till the summer.
I am.
But this is good direction because now we know what to work on.
Yep.
You know.
Yeah, I know that the thing we're voting for is either one or two,
yeah.
And I'm going for two. But
no, we appreciate the input on those things.
You know, I grew up in IB with a bunch of people that aren't really diplomatic. So, what's demeaning is having an outside industry come and shove an initiative and referendum down our throats to allow for manufacturing, industrial manufacturing in a residential area. That's crazy. So if you think you heard me, I was demeaning now, you wait till the election because you haven't seen anything yet. This city will go after the marijuana industry, not because we're against weed or cannabis, because an outside industry has come here and shoved this down our throat I think, Mr. Young, you talked about putting a gun to our head into the media. We can use that quote in the election, but the reality is we went through a long process for this, and you guys could have decided to go somewhere else. Given the fact that we just had a 116 million gallon sewer spill, you've decided to come to IB, the city that's facing the worst pollution problem in North America, if not the planet, and make things worse for us and give us more work to do. Shame on you. That is immoral. That is unethical. It's insulting. And basically, this and your initiative will have its butt kicked in by the people. I guarantee you, IB will rally like never before because we hate having outsiders dictate us. We don't want to go back to the old days. We had the rat. We had lots of land and IB. We're not going back to that. But more importantly, we have a city council. We have zoning laws because they're carefully thought out. It requires lots of discussion. And the city council is elected to basically help balance those with what the residents want. So you guys have overplayed your hand. It's absolutely disgusting what you've done. And I am going to, like I said, if you are upset with what I'm saying now, I can't wait to go on the election warpath, because that's what's going to happen. You are going to regret that you've done this. More importantly, you've given us a national platform to rail against the immorality and unethical behavior of the marijuana industry. Absolutely ridiculous. This is like one of those Clint Eastwood movies where the bad guys show up, and basically go after the good townspeople, and that's what you've done. So I'll take a little break from fighting the bad guy and unethical and corrupt people that are dumping toxic waste on us, and I can't wait to go the unethical and bad people that are going to shove a bunch of manufacturing facilities next to our residents. It's absolutely unacceptable, absolutely unethical, and the wrong thing to do. So I haven't even gotten started yet. So with that, obviously I want to see this as an initiative. I like the idea of having our own initiative. You know, the reality is we permitted marijuana to be sold recreationally, and that's not enough for you guys. And, you know, you've acted in bad faith. It just drives me crazy that we're wasting our time on this. We spent hours and hours and hours on this, and you guys don't have the good sense to realize that you're coming into a working-class community besieged by all kinds of problems. You're going to make things worse. It's really, really bad, and it shows an absolute lack of judgment, morality for that matter. It's selfish and it's unacceptable. So can't wait to beat it at the ballot box. So with that, obviously I'm not diplomatic on this. So I think it's very clear the council doesn't want to just adopt the initiative. So I guess the motion is to adopt resolution numbers 2019, 88, 8081, and 82, calling the next regular municipal election on November 3rd, 2020. And adding the proposed measure to the November 3rd, 2020 election, requesting the county consolidate the regular municipal election with a statewide general election, directing the city attorney to prepare an impartial analysis, setting priorities for filing written arguments, and providing for the refiling of rebuttal arguments. Is there a motion? Yeah. Second, please vote.
Motion carried unanimously.
Now we have, I think you've received direction from the council, Mr. City Manager, that you want to...
I'm unclear, but...
Yeah, okay.
We will bring back future agenda items related to competing ballot measures, tax initiatives, et cetera. Thank you.
Are we done? Good. Okay, great. And now we have number 5.2, Housing Needs Assessment and Opportunities. Assistant City Manager Dish will give the report.
Thank you, Mayor. So this is a discussion item to discuss housing in Imperial Beach and just to try to segment it into some needs, issues, and opportunities. So again, the what is a discussion to outline various housing complexities and try to segment those into discussion topics, again, through identifying what are the needs of housing in Imperial Beach, what are some of the issues, and then, again, what are some of our opportunities. And why? Why have this discussion? To help guide Imperial Beach's housing outlook and policies in the future. So real briefly, and again, these are intended to just sort of, tee up a discussion here and have a thoughtful discussion. So without a doubt, I mean, Imperial Beach, as well as the region, is in need of housing. We certainly understand the issues that the county has and the allocation that the state HCD has provided to the county, and then again SANDAG's responsibility to come up with a methodology that we've spoken about in this chambers a number of times through the RENA allocation. And again, the Imperial Beach need for housing is a lot of workforce housing. You know, Andy, our city manager Hall, had done a presentation on, you know, the housing affordability to the council not too long ago in terms of, you know, how much would it take in order to afford the median home price here, and the amount of income it would take in order to afford that greatly exceeded the median income for our community. And again, the other issue again is always funding, right? I mean, there's a gap, and I just spoke to that between incomes and housing in this community, and so there is a need to bridge that gap. So those are a couple of the needs. So what are the issues? And I apologize that this is just words, because it's kind of tough to put graphics on some of these issues. But land prices, I mean, you know, in what we're doing in planning and development all the time, you know, we're seeing applications come in, and the land prices for vacant and even occupied properties in Imperial Beach continues to go up. We every quarter receive certain reports, and annually we see percentage-wise the property values of Imperial Beach outpacing that of our counterpart cities in the county. The entitlement process for some, especially here in California, because again, and I mentioned the California sort of comment, because housing is not just an issue here in Imperial Beach or San Diego or California. It is a national issue, and cities are dealing with this all across the country. And perhaps in California, it's more acute from the entitlement process standpoint because of CEQA, and we're a coastal community. So we also have the California Coastal Commission. And again, there are lots of checks and balances there. Labor, there's a labor shortage. After the last sort of bust boom cycle that we had in the housing, and we had the economy in a tank around what, 2007, 2008-ish, a lot of the labor in the construction trades went away, and there is a huge need for labor, skilled labor, for construction, and that's driving up prices, and it's causing additional delays. Infrastructure capacity. So this is one of the non-sexy things to talk about, but it's super important, because when we take a look at developing a city, your city and your city engineers try to do a really good job of making sure that we don't oversize and we don't undersize. Just like, you know, schools try to build schools that are going to accommodate student needs. You don't want one too big, and you don't want it too small. So infrastructure, what I'm talking about here is the physical infrastructure. You know, our roads, our sewer, our water, our electric capacity, all those things are sized right based upon what our projected sort of land use and zoning is. And so when we start to take a look at an increase in various types of housing to fulfill certain needs, that can put a strain on some of our infrastructure. And then again, I put NIMBY and community character here, not as sort of negative issues, but just as things to bring to our attention, because again, you as policymakers and decision makers are going to be faced with, you know, very difficult decisions when it comes to looking at how we develop as a community in the future in order to accommodate some of those needs. And so some of the tasks that we have ahead of us are to recognize those issues and try to be as thoughtful about a process and what are those issues as they come forward to you. So what are our opportunities? There are legislative opportunities. You know, one of the things that comes to mind when we start to take a look at what can we do as a community to sort of bridge that gap in terms of housing is redevelopment was taken away in the state of California. And there are sort of bits and pieces that have been cobbled together through the years. But there's a huge opportunity to reinstate redevelopment, and there are discussions about that at the state level, and we hear that throughout some of our League of California meetings, City Managers Association, Planning Association talks a little bit about this a lot. And I know that you as policymakers are dialed into some of those discussions. But that would really help to sort of bridge that gap. The other opportunity is our upcoming housing element. Through your last budget cycle, you authorized dollars for us to go and update our required housing element. We have issued an RFP, and we've received a couple of responses back. that's kind of also part and parcel to the labor shortage I talked about earlier. There, right now, consulting is a good business to be in. There, people are very busy. There's lots of work to do, and there's very little sort of responses to some of these RFPs that we put out. But we did get a couple of responses. We'll be going through those, and we'll be looking for you to authorize a contract here in the near future. But what that housing element will allow us to do is will allow us to sort of affirm what the community's vision is for how Imperial Beach is going to look like, recognizing that we have to allow for and provide for the ability to accommodate, you know, housing allocations that have been identified to us. So, again, that's a sort of brief summary for a very complex topic. And again, I think the purpose of this was for us to just sort of understand where we're at with housing and to have a thoughtful dialogue as we move forward. And again, try to divvy up this complexity of issues into sort of what, again, the needs, the issues, and the opportunities.
Mr. Hall, did you have any additional comments? Or?
No, Mayor, I just think it was important for us as we get started in our new housing element that we just kind of come to the council and give you guys an opportunity to give us some immediate direction, and that way we can move forward and prepare the kind of information that you guys are going to need to make some of these serious decisions. I do know, though, that you had mentioned that you wanted to defer some of your
well,
time.
Well, I mean, I think we have comments. I want to make sure just we're clear on process. Right now we have an LCP. That doesn't include, that's independent of a housing element. Is that correct? Or during the LCP process, housing element is completely separate. Is that right? Or is it a housing element part of the LCP?
No, it's not part of our LCP and general plan update, but it is required by the state for us to update our housing element, which is part of our general plan. On a regular basis.
So, and we're updating our LCP, and we're talking about the housing element. At no point are we talking about changing zoning or density or anything like that. Our zoning or codes are all staying the same. Is that correct?
Well, right now, the LCP, our local coastal program, and our general plan don't anticipate any land use changes, but for actually one where there's a proposal for one of the ponds, which is identified as an urban reserve, to turn that to open space. We are proposing some zoning changes, but they're not necessarily related to density or land use changes. It's basically clarifying language. Effectively, the phase two of the ad hoc zoning committee that Councilmember Spriggs had sat on to clarify some procedural things to... Yes, I'm sorry, and I'm slow.
You're still recovering from the run.
So those two folks sat on the ad hoc, and there were a couple of different phases, so it's implementing part of those things. If there are any proposed changes that would be necessary, those would be sort of filtered out through the housing element process. But again, to be clear, to your point, right now the LCP and the general plan aren't proposing any sort of increase in land use intensities or zone changes to increase density.
And I want to make sure this RENA stuff, because I think it was important. We met with SANDAG to strongly, before any of the voting took place, to strongly say that we are against all the recommended numbers. And I made it very clear in the comments that, you know, it was outrageous the numbers are being proposed. But SANDAG made it really clear that they can't make our city do this. The state or SANDAG can't force us, like the marijuana industry, to sort of like put a gun to our head and build 1,300 units, because that's a market-driven approach and it's regulated by our zoning. So SANDAG or the state can't legally change our zoning and force us to do something that the market can't bear. And more importantly, our zoning doesn't allow it. Is that clear? Is that correct?
Yeah, the zoning is a local issue, and right. The city council establishes zoning. What I think was SANDAG's intention in the beginning, and I think that this is something that we want to revisit, because remember, we still have a period here where we can go back and ask SANDAG to take another look at this, is that I think their original intention was to accommodate all of these RENA numbers within city's general plans. So they took a look at all the city's general plans, and if you maxed out all of your general plans, then you could accommodate the RENA numbers. What we're less sure about and what we want to look into is with the change to where they changed how they define now the transit stops, did they take into account that, wait a minute, the four cities that you impacted, did you impact them so much that now their general plans can't accommodate this housing? And that's something that we, at this point, we haven't had a chance to analyze. But as we move forward, that's going to be a really important thing, because that their intention was to not have anybody have to amend their general plan or zoning ordinance. And you may have, you know, Steve sat on those committees, so he may have some more input on that. But that was their initial that was their initial intention, was to not have anybody have to make any changes to their general plan of the zoning.
Yeah, the only thing that I would augment on that discussion is that there is a finding that has to be made that your existing land use and zoning needs to have the ability to accommodate what the allocation is, and that's a state law. And so, again, I think the challenge and the effort for us as we move through our housing element is to make sure that the community vision, the guiding principles behind what IB is, you know, the on the back of our business card, the one that Andy quotes all the time, right, that we maintain that. And there's lots of different ways to do that. And so that will be our charge, is to come up with a methodology to make sure that we comply with the provisions of state law. Because, again, the way that trickles down is the state requires HCD to come up with these numbers. HCD provides those numbers to SANDAG. SANDAG allocates those. We then have to sort of trickle back up and make sure that we can accommodate that. But you're absolutely right, Mayor, insofar as there is a reality, and that's what we try to convey through this process, is that we cities, we don't build housing.
Right.
We don't have redevelopment. We cannot compel somebody to come and build something, even if we had hundreds of acres available.
We're not the Soviet Union. We don't have a housing, you know, we don't build monstrous blocks.
Right, right. And we don't have a housing authority like, you know, the infamous Cabrini Greens in Chicago, where they built them and then they tore them down. So but again, to your point, even if we had hundreds of acres of vacant land and we had all the capacity in terms of allowing that density to be realized, we can't compel somebody to come in there and build. That's outside of our control.
Mr.
Yeah, I just want to cover. So I want to really discuss what happened at SANDAG. So I want you to know this was the third meeting that we were supposed to attend. So this was teed up three times that we had gone. So it wasn't I didn't walk into that meeting and with nothing and I had done research ahead and talked to officials at SANDAG and officials at the HCD and also some state officials, and I initially, when Mr. Hall and I and Mr. Dush met and we talked about a small city carve out, and it was flatly rejected. It was flatly rejected that was not the way that they were going to allow it, because it's called the regional housing needs assessment, not a regional housing need assessment with a local city cutout. So, or small city cutout. So I knew that was going on. And if you watch the SANDAG meet, you'll notice that the vice chair, Mayor Bakespear, actually said that exact same thing when it happened. So I knew that going down that road, and I had discussed this. They were not willing. They said this was not going to be a path that we were going to be able to follow down, and it was a waste of time. And we didn't know, even if it would have passed, it probably would have gotten a weighted vote. So there's a lot to this. There were three motions that were made that day. The first motion was made to pass it. Mayor Faulkner and Mayor Salas immediately did that. The next motion was actually from Mayor Voss, which was the small city carve-out. The third motion, which was what City Manager Hall is talking about, is redefining those transportation zones, because that is the key to this. This takes housing needs to be built. People are not being able to afford to live here in their community. That redefining the transit stops takes our housing and more equitably distributes it throughout our entire county. It's a plain and simple truth. The National City Mayor and I, Sotelo Solis, came together. We tried to make that motion, and unfortunately, nobody thought that through. So it is an unfortunate thing, and I think as soon as we were done, that motion did not pass. The next motion did not pass. But we did. All the cities came together and said no to the overall number. But unfortunately, the weighted vote is what won it. And that was, obviously, when you've got the mayor of San Diego and the council member from San Diego and Mayor Salas from Chula Vista, that's almost impossible to beat. Those numbers, that takes it to a 79 percentile, and we lost it at that time. So I want you to know, there was a whole thought process that was much more in depth and much more than just one vote. So it was a process. So.
Mr. West, Erica, I know you had a public comment card, so I apologize for, thank you for that comment. Yeah. And then I'd like to open the public comment period now, so I know you are. Thank you.
Well, you know, first, Lena, I promise this is going to be the last time I talk tonight. I cried, I yelled, I screamed, I hid. I was angry, mad, hysterical. I was disappointed. It was to the point that my husband brought me chocolate cake. It took me 3 days before I realized that I really was on TV and not just in the background, which started the whole process over again. This was my reaction to the Sand Egg Board when they heavy-handedly forced 13,075 residences onto our city.
1,300.
Thank you. We were not heard. Our voices were silenced. Right now, I still feel powerless. I hear the report and go, we'll be pushed through and we'll end up looking like a low-income version of Miami Beach in a decade or so if Sand Egg has its way. That is not what I want for my son. This is his home. This is the only home he's ever known. The only home he really wants, well, except now that he wants a two-story mansion, but we won't talk about that. But there were a number of takeaways from the Sand Egg meeting. First was the professor, Councilwoman Terry Gasterland, I hope I said her name right, that stated the assumptions provided from the state were inaccurate and Newport Beach is fighting them, which was really actually interesting. Second, we were not alone. Coronado is fighting this and possibly taking it to the state. Third, we may be one small community, but we also count. We have three speakers and more people in the audience. I also want to openly state my appreciation to Congressman Bilbray for opening this conversation up and his continued support through all this. We have hope, slim as it may be. I would like to see our council show their true merit and take up with our neighboring small cities and bring this issue back to the state for a more sensible and equitable redistribution.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Any more public comment cards?
No, Mr. Mayor.
That closes the public comment. Any additional comment from the council?
I have some specific thoughts about our process, the council, that weren't respected at Sand Egg. And I have some thoughts about this challenge going forward for us as a community. I think all of us as elected officials have bought into the mission statement to maintain and enhance Imperial Beach as classic Southern California, a beach-oriented community with a safe, small-town, family atmosphere, rich in natural and cultural resource. This is what we all run on. This is why we're here. And there are certain existential threats to that kind of community going forward. We know two of them. We've already talked about them many times. One is, of course, the cross-border pollution issue, which affects our quality of life, the quality of life of everybody in this town, as well as our tourism, as well as our property values, et cetera. The other is climate change and sea level rise. We've talked about that quite a bit tonight, and we've taken action on that tonight, and we've taken other action. But the third is how much growth and density is appropriate for Imperial Beach if we're going to maintain the small town beach environment that everybody loves, every single person in this town cherishes. This is our trust as a city council, I believe, particularly this council, from what I know of everybody on the council, to try to maintain this community in that towards that mission or vision. So I'm a little bit puzzled about what happened, my colleague, because it doesn't matter who else outside of this community. I don't care whether they're the governor or a state legislator or somebody on the Sand Egg staff or whoever. There's a difference between representing our city council on Sand Egg, on Metro JPA, on League of California Cities, on MTA, in general. You make the best judgment you can based on the issues that come forward. But when the city council has deliberated already on an issue and taken a position and has asked that position to be represented at Sandet, that is the end of the discretion of the external influences of the independent judgment, etc., it seems to me. How else can we expect our decisions on the council, our guidance to staff, our guidance to each other in terms of how we should act in a given manner, to be adhered to if it can be changed so easily? So the vote was one vote away from the carve-out for small cities. The carve-out for small cities would have taken our numbers down by 55%. It wouldn't have been as good as the formulaic adjustment that we went after, that we wanted, which was defeated. But the majority would have been in favor of the carve-out, and some of the bigger cities favored the carve-out for the smaller town. It just seems to me that we've made ourselves now a more difficult path forward if we want to appeal this to Sandet, and we want to appeal it to HCD, or we want to go back to our state legislators and say this is unfair, when we had the opportunity to vote for something that would have given us the relief, or close to it, that we wanted, and that would have implemented the council's very detailed, long discussion about what the last time we talked about the RENA numbers, that would have implemented that. Now we don't have that. Now, I can't say anything more about that. Councilmember West has stated his reasons. I feel responsible, even though it may cause some friction, to say what I think about it, because I think it has implications that go to an existential issue, that go to council protocol, and that go to our ability to seek remedies going forward. So having said that, I think that we have still got to try as a council to reverse the Sandag decision and get our numbers down. It's been difficult because we didn't get the support that we wanted from Chula Vista and some other, and most of the other Sandag members to change the formula based on number of bus routes and that sort of thing that we discussed in great detail at our last discussion on this. So we've got to find some other avenues. I don't buy the argument that we're going to get off the hook because we don't have the zoning and we don't have the space for the housing and the developers aren't interested anyway. So we don't really have to worry that much about it. I don't buy that. First of all, there's a lot of opinion in Sacramento that the problem with housing in the state of California is the NIMBY attitude of the cities in the state of California, that they don't want it and they discourage it and they have a lot of red tape, etc. I know this is the case because I'm an active member of the League of California Cities Housing Community and Economic Development Policy Committee, and four times a year when we meet and consider state legislation, whether to support it or oppose it, this is the notion of the state legislators that want to force more housing into local communities regardless of their zoning. So we have provisions already that will allow developers by right to put housing, multifamily housing, high density housing in Imperial Beach and other California cities. There are more such bills on the way. That's a whole separate subject that I think we need to actually have a workshop on and figure out how we defend against by right development in Imperial Beach. But it's related because we may be penalized financially or in terms of lack of access to money for road if we don't meet the RENA numbers. This is something that is actually actively being considered by various legislators in Sacramento because California does have a housing crisis and people are looking for solutions. They're looking for scapegoats. They're looking for somebody to blame. So this opens us up to that kind of potential liability. I'm not sure whether how it will unfold, but it's there. We talked about this at our last meeting. Finally, we as a council have got to acquire the expertise needed to not only develop a housing element, which is every time we've done a housing element, it's been basically take the last one, update it, fill in the blank, and there's your housing element, and nobody takes it that seriously. Now we've got a housing element with numbers in it that are going to significantly potentially change our community, and we've got to figure out how to address that housing element with these new numbers. I'm glad we have two, as Assistant City Manager Dush says, we have two candidates. I don't know if what their qualifications are, but it seems to me that we need some extraordinary strategic advice on how to navigate potential adjustments we may need to make in our zoning, how we might construct our arguments regarding appealing these numbers, and how we might want to counter the developer incentives that actually could make these numbers a reality in Imperial Beach. If somebody can put a high rise up near a major bus station that's towards the western end of Route 75 and put up a 5 or 6 story building by right, the first 2 or 3 floors will have affordable housing that gives them the density bonuses that they need for the greater height. The top 3 can be ocean view condos that are worth the money that'll make that project pencil in. And they won't have to put in adequate parking or open space or other benefits to the community that our local zoning would otherwise have required. This is state law that gives them this by right opportunity to develop these kinds of structures. And I'm just saying that we've got to start taking this stuff a lot more seriously. This is an existential issue for Imperial Beach in terms of maintaining the character of this community. And please, colleagues, let's work together to make sure that we use every opportunity and employ the kind of expertise that we need to adopt countermeasures for what is coming down on us, whether it's RENA and housing community development, or whether it's the state legislators that are trying to find and be heroes on the and solving the housing problem in California, or whether it's SANDAG, etc. And let's not shoot ourselves in the foot by being complacent or by not taking every opportunity, including SANDAG vote, to stick up for the community and to make sure that we don't have these pressures on us whenever the opportunity presents itself to avoid them. So, I've said way more than I probably should. I like to maintain good working relationships with my colleagues, but this is one of the three existential issues, not something we can play with. And it's about this community, and it's not about what other people are saying outside of this community. It's about what's in the best interest of this community. That's why we're elected.
Thank you, Mr. Spriggs. Mr. Patton?
Yeah, this will be quick. Well, you talked about building high-rises, then you talked about let's fight this. So which one do you want? Because I want to fight this, and Mr. West, thank you. You know what you did? You were there. We weren't. And you had a rationale for your explanation. And that's all I have to say.
Council Member Gary.
I think it's without a question that no one wants to see the 375 units built in IB.
175.
Or whatever the number it is. We don't want it, right? We've all been in agreement. We don't want to see that. It's unattainable. It'll burden the infrastructure. It'll take away from our mission, from our vision, from our community. We are already on the daily feeling the effects of a system that's overpressured, right? Tijuana built too fast for the system, for its infrastructure, for its sewage, and that's why we always have collapses and breaks, and we are at the tail end of that. I also want to say I have full confidence in Councilmember West, and I know that he went to that meeting with the best interest of the city of Imperial Beach and its residents at heart, and he did his due diligence. And I have to say that I don't appreciate his integrity being put into question. You're talking about teamwork, but I don't believe you are displaying that. So I just want to make that comment that I have full confidence, just as we do have full confidence in you, Mr. Spriggs, every time you go to all the League of Cities meetings as well. So I just wanted to say that.
So I think the consensus is we need to pursue the issue of the Sandag vote and figure out how we can maybe change those numbers. I mean, the reality of the numbers I threw out were the two chairs of Sandag, the chair of Poway, from Chairman Voss from Poway and vice chair from Encinitas, both had lower numbers than us. And I think Poway's, is it? I'm not sure how many squares. Is it 25 square miles? And then Encinitas is 12 square miles or something like that. But crazy. Like, yeah. And so, obviously, not good. Do I think that developers are going to come here and build 20-story buildings? Absolutely not. You know, we can't get people to build affordable housing and housing projects now. It's not, you know, the market, especially with labor, isn't going to happen. But, I mean, the reality is, how many people here could afford to buy their house right now? Raise your hand if you could afford to spend $1 million on your house. I bought my house for $235. I think it's worth $700 now, which doesn't mean anything to me because I don't have that kind of money. My dad bought his house for $80,000, I think, and he just passed away. My parents bought it for $80,000. Now it's worth $700,000, $800,000 after I have to fix it up. So, you know, it's all irrelevant. I know, Mr. Patton, there's no way you could afford to buy your house now. None of us could. None of us could. So the issue is my kids are never going to be able to afford a house. My son, I don't know, he's living in UCLA and spending, I don't know how much money we spend for a shoebox. My other son doesn't want to come back here because he can't afford to live here. And so that's killing, it's killing California. So I think the idea is let's figure out how to march to our own destiny, do this housing element. We're not going to change density. We're not going to change our zoning and figure out how to get some more affordable housing so our kids can afford to live here. But, you know, and I think, right, we're going to, I think there's consensus in Sacramento. I disagree, Mr. Spriggs. I think there's lots of consensus in Sacramento that coastal cities aren't going to be overrun with high-rise buildings. State head of the state senate, Tony Atkins, used to represent IB, has made it really clear that's not going to happen. And so I think we have an opportunity to go back and make a fair argument that, right, along with Coronado, it doesn't make any sense for us to have more housing than, and I made those arguments, believe me, stronger than anybody. On the other hand, Hassan, kind of from Sandag, said, you know what, this not going to happen. I don't think Governor Newsom's going to hold us accountable and cut our money. That's just not going to happen. I can guarantee you they're not going to pick on IB. They're not the marijuana industry. But do I think we need to be more aggressive in dealing with these numbers? Absolutely. Do I think we need to find some more affordable housing? Absolutely. Should we do our housing element? Yes. Do we want to change zoning and density? No. But when you see trolls and people with signs up saying that IB is going to change density, call them out because we're not. You know, I think the world of social media and troll culture and IB, it's just a different lie every day about what IB's doing. And so it's really important to have the right, you know, evidence and the right information. And so let's just make it clear. The LCP is not going to change density. It's not going to change our zoning. And we have no intention of doing that. It's been made very clear. But do we need to find more affordable housing, middle-class housing for working families? Absolutely.
You know, Mayor, if I can just add a couple of things. One, you know, I know that I'm hearing from the City Council that you want us to look at ways and different ways to see if there's some way to lower the allocation that we've received, and I think we're going to have to approach that fact-driven, right? I mean, we can go make emotional pleas, but in reality, I think some of that's going to be fact-driven. So staff has already started to look at some of the fallacies that have happened. Now, one of them is we think that they counted too many bus stops that don't operate the way they used to in our city. So remember when they changed the definition so that the only bus stops that count are those that have two buses that kind of crisscross or two head-end buses in one spot. In talking with our public works director and some of the things we've gone out and looked at, a couple of those bus stops have been modified lately, and we don't think they operate that way. And so we, just so you know, staff is looking at preparing for you what would be a factual. Clearly there's a motion here, and I think that we need to make sure that people understand our emotion when we go to Sandag, but I think it has to be backed up also with some of the fallacies in their formula so that they can rethink the formula and make sure that it's more fair and more equitable across the county. I don't think it can be purely emotional. And so I just want you to know we are looking at ways that we can provide you so that you can go back to Sandag with some facts.
Anyway, I think we've gotten you a direction, and with that, we are going to adjourn the regular meeting. Thank you very much.
I'm not riding, and I go to the races, and I like to play a little bit. Horse Daddy. Why do you like that horse? Because of the name. And they're up at the window cashing, and I'm sitting there watching, so.
One of the things that eluded you in your career is the Triple Crown.
Yeah.
Did you ever think that you would see a horse win the Triple Crown in your lifetime? Because now we've had two.
Had two in 3 years.
Yeah.
And no, I didn't. I thought it was probably the most difficult feat in all of sport, because you're getting new challengers in every leg of the Triple Crown. And if you look back at the Triple Crown winners of past 30, 40 years ago, they were winning derbies that had 7, 8 horses in them, and Preaknesses that had 6 horses in them, and Belmont with 11 horses. Now the Derby is 20 horses every single year. You got a full gate for the Preakness at 14. You got a full gate for the Belmont at 14. And what Bob Baffert did with American Pharoah, and then Justify, a horse that didn't even run as a 2-year-old, to come along in 2018, it was a gift for our sport, and a gift for me to be able to witness it and watch my close friend Mike Smith go through that Triple Crown. And if anybody was ever deserving of winning a Triple Crown, it was Mike.
A female jockey hasn't competed in a Triple Crown race in 4 years. First of all, why do you think that is?
Well, it's difficult for either sex to get that type of business at the upper echelon. And Rosie Napravnik was the last one to be at that level. There's quite a few young ladies out there that are performing right now that are going to be of that. Rosie or a Julie Crone type of rider, and people, one of the most common questions I get is, what about riding with women, jockey? Well, between Rosie and Julie Crone, trust me, when you're coming down the stretch next to them, I don't care what their undergarments were or whatever, because they were riding just as tough as any man that I ever came through the stretch with. So, you know, it's all about what type of horses you're able to draw your way and how your career goes on at an early, and getting those opportunities and then capitalizing on the opportunities once they're put in front of you.
Is it that there are not enough opportunities for women to kind of get involved for whatever reason, or is it that there are not as many women involved as men?
I just think there's not as many women as involved as men. Charlie Whittingham, one of the greatest trainers of all time, legendary American trainer, he had what they called Charlie's Angels. All of his exercise girls were, he had all female because they just got along. He felt better than than a young man may. But there are plenty of exercise girls on the back stretch that just choose not to go towards the full on being a jockey. I think there's a lot of demands on a jockey's life, female or male. You've got the weight restrictions, constant battle with that. And I mean, I've been retired for 3 months now, and week after I was finished, right, I went from weighing 115 to 130 like that, and it felt good. So
I'm glad you're happy.
Yeah, it's all right.
Coming up, Gary Stevens goes the distance in our first and 10. Don't move. Coming up, first superstitious thing you do before a big race.
Pull out the lucky underwear.
What? You have lucky underwear? First misconception about horse jockeys. That's next.
Stay on the lookout with Next Gen Rear Camera Mirror Tech. In the sporty, spacious, crew-ready Cadillac XT6.
Okay, the new masculine fragrance by Dolce & Gabbana.
At Macy's, the fragrance destination.
Napa know-how isn't just for car guys.
Power tools.
Every driver deserves quality parts.
Practical and cool.
Do it yourself with Napa Auto Parts or have it done for you at a Napa Auto Care Center. That's Napa know-how.
Napa know-how!
When the city is your fairway, and there's no such thing as out of bounds, the only thing better than the perfect shot is knowing that no one is actually keeping score. Do it for the cheers.
Start Saturday strong with Big Noon Saturday on Fox. It's a battle of Big Ten contenders as number 11 Michigan takes on number 13 Wisconsin. Heisman hopeful Jonathan Taylor.
See you later!
Looks to run all over Harbaugh's bruising defense. It all starts with the Big Noon Kickoff pregame show at 11. And then it's Michigan, Wisconsin. All part of Big Noon Saturday on Fox.
Don't let a bad connection slow your business down. Make the switch to Cox Business to get fast, reliable internet. From 25 megs to gig speeds. Stay protected from viruses and malware with our security suite and schedule automatic online backups. Bundle with voice solutions you can manage from any device, in or out of the office. And it's all backed by our 24/7 business class support. Get the service you expect from the experts you deserve with Cox Business. Enjoy this limited time offer when you switch today.
Kia summer sales event going on now at Kia of Chula Vista. All 2019 Kias are sale priced. Kia is offering 0% for 75 months. Kia of Chula Vista. Exit 3 off the 805 at Auto Park Drive. Kia of Chula Vista. It's that easy.